And then Elijah, I'll let you do the honors of the
draw. Got it, Liana. We love you, bro.
I'm so sorry.
All right, Elijah, hit it mid hole.
We're out of here. We're gonna do 90 people in the first minute. All right, dude. I'm letting them all in. Here we come. Here they go. Here they come.
Yo, wait.
No way.
There's so many people. That's crazy.
What?
This is crazy.
I think we should have expanded to 1,000.
I told you. Colin, you know what the 1,000 people Zoom calls are for? They're for like businesses, like huge businesses with like super computers to get 1,000.
That's great.
Wow.
Hold on,
I'm
Georgia.
You guys started this. Oh, wow.
That's so cool.
So I'm going to wait until it hits zero, and then once everybody's in, let's get things going. But this is like...
Oh,
dude, I had this gut feeling. I knew yesterday when we were talking about should we expand to 1,000, I was praying and I felt like the Holy Spirit be like 1,000, and then I was like, no.
I feel bad because I was the person who was like, nah, we're not gonna hit 500, we're not gonna do it. And then 1 minute in, 1 minute in, oh my Lord. Okay, so we are at capacity, I believe.
Wow.
Sheesh. Okay, hold on. It's going all the way down. We were sitting at 50 more people in the waiting room.
I see so many
people. The first minute, bro. It was 8:01. It was 8:01, and there were 500 people waiting.
This is insane.
Wow. Wow.
Lord.
Bro, I this told you, next time we just have to update to 1,000. We just have, I'm going to have to, like.
We have to.
I'm going to have to put a whole second router so we can, like, power this.
Wait. Can we update 1,000 in the middle of the stream?
I think this was a sign in the future. We have to do more of these, you know?
No. I don't think I can upgrade in the middle of one.
Elijah.
And 500 people are in.
Dang.
All right, so. With that, so.
I think we should turn off the video.
So, thank you so much for joining. This is. I know, at least for me, this far exceeded anything that I could have imagined. Like, how this even started was in Colin and Elijah's live, I believe. And someone brought up that, hey,
and Elijah's live.
Testimony night. Again, blowing my mind. That being said, we're going to go through quick and just give a little quick hello. If you guys do not know me, my name is Garrett. And with that, whoever is next would like to say hi.
Real quick, because there's so many people in here. I need a like crap ton of you to just turn your videos off because it will lag. Listen, I'm running this on my 2013 MacBook, and if every video is on, my computer might explode. And I don't want anybody to lag out. I want you guys to be able to hear everyone when they're talking. And so if you could just do me a huge solid favor, I just need a good amount of you to just turn them off. I know I won't be seeing your pretty face, but look, there's so many of you, I can only see the first page. So it's like, I probably won't even see, none of us will even see you anyway. And so many of these people are going to be crying, so they probably won't even be able to see the screen, like, through the tears, you know? So it's whatever, bro. So just shut the video off, help us out, do us a big favor, and then I'm going to unmute all our speakers right now. I unmuted them a second ago, but I'm unmuting all of you. Anyway, hi, I'm Elijah. Hi, if you don't know, how's it going? And then I'll unmute all these people. Okay.
I've never heard of you.
You really?
No, honestly, this is a first for me.
That sucks for me, I guess.
Yeah.
Hey, who invited him to this?
Garrett. But, like, Garrett is 1 year, so, like, he kind of invites weirdos, so.
Colin, did he invite you?
Oh.
Okay, I did unmute you. Wait, where are you? Where'd you go? Oh, I asked to unmute you. Okay, introduce yourselves, you fools.
Dang.
Hi, I'm
same order that we prayed in, guys.
What's up? I'm Cameron. How you doing?
Hey, I'm Connor.
I'm Mackenzie. I don't know.
I'm Colin, y'all.
I'm Brooks.
I'm Liana. Hi.
What's up?
Okay, and that was everybody, I believe, right? Alright, so with that, we are going to have our boy Colin open us up in prayer, and then after that, The very first person who's going to share their testimony tonight is none other than the Elijah Lamb. So with that, Colin, take it away, my dude.
Father, we just thank you so much for this opportunity, man. God, you exceed our expectations every single day. You blow our minds, 500 people, and not 10 minutes, not 15 minutes, but in 1 minute, God, you over exceed and push the boundaries of what we even believe is possible. So Father, we just thank you so much for your blessings, your glory, for even the possibility that we have technology so we can all sit here in our rooms, sit in our houses, sit in safe places or places which I hope are safe, and to be able to listen to testimonies, to listen to what you've done, to your blessings, your miracles, to your stories, God. We pray that you would just move, your Holy Spirit would be invited in here tonight, that those that need to hear certain stories would hear those certain stories, that these stories would resonate, that the testimonies, I don't even want to say stories because stories are something that's been told, but testimonies, God, testimonies to what you've done in our life, testimonies to how you've changed our life. Father, let your words speak tonight, not our words. If anything is of our words, that we would, everyone would forget it, and that those things that are of your words and that is of your holiness, God, that it would stick and resonate with everyone, and that everything that is spoken in this stream tonight just is completely filled with your Holy Spirit. So, Father, we just thank you. We ask you into this. We pray that you would strengthen everyone to speak their testimonies and as well allow us to be vulnerable and to pick up our crosses tonight. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right, bro. Thank you, Colin, for putting us in there. Hi, everybody, again. I'm Elijah, if y'all don't know me. Super glad all you guys are here. And I just want to share with you the story that God has given me. And just the way that he totally changed my life, like completely. I see a lot of familiar faces. I know a lot of you have been on my Zooms before, like where I do the Q&A and stuff. And like the guy that you see in those calls is not who I was 3 years ago, let alone a year ago. But yeah, so backstory. I was born in Lincoln, Nebraska, not too far from Garrett. He's in Iowa. Midwest people are so boring. But anyway, I grew up in Lincoln, Nebraska. First 7 years of my life is where I was from. That's where I grew up. And my family has like always been plugged into church. I always went as a kid. We moved to Florida when I was seven because my dad like was always traveling for work. And it was just like really rough. We were broke and it was like something needs to change. And so we moved to Florida where real estate was really cheap or something. I don't really know the economy of 2008, but that's where we ended up. And so we moved out to Florida. And things were quickly very different, as you can imagine. School-wise, I went to three different elementary schools, two different middle schools, and I'm now going to my second high school this year. Moved around a ton. Picked up and moved and put myself in new communities all the time. But the one consistent place I had was my church. We found my church when I was in Florida for a couple months, and then we stuck there. And I still go there now. I grew up going to church, but by no means did I grow up in a Christian home. It's not how I would explain it. I think if you hear stuff in the background, that's my nephew. I don't know if you guys can hear that, but that's what it is. That's my niece. They're having a great time outside. So I grew up going to church with my family, but by no means did I grow up in a Christian home. That's actually not Jackson. That is Ava. It's a different child. Everyone commenting Jackson. I think my parents and I think my dad has sort of expressed this to me now that he made us go to church as kids because he was guilty that he wasn't raising us the way that he knew he should. I grew up in like a very, very, very broken home. My parents were both struggling with alcoholism. My dad had to work constantly. So I looked up to him a ton, but he wasn't around as much as I would have loved as a kid. My relationship with my siblings was just rough. My sister sort of ignored me. My older brother was emotionally and physically abusive towards me. And my, I'm on a Zoom call.
You want anything from Jeremiah?
Nope, I'm okay. Love you. Bye. Okay. Sorry. My family is so sporadic. So many interruptions. Anyway, But yeah, my relationship with my older brother was really rough. Him and I have different dads. And I think the pain he felt from losing his dad at a young age, he really, really took out on me. Didn't know how to handle it. I mean, he was in and out of trouble as a kid. But yeah, he used to like really, really beat me up and talk down to me really bad until he moved out. And my younger brother would team up with my older brother. That's the disease of being a middle child. And tag team me. And so that was the home life for a really long time. The only people I had that were like an image of Christ in my life were my grandparents, but they live in Nebraska. And so I was sort of snatched away from them at a young age. Moving on, middle school was when, you know, my life really went downhill. I was still going to church. I still found comfort there, but the people I chose to surround myself, well, I mean, going into sixth grade, I moved schools and I was emo and weird and I just didn't really fit in anywhere. And so my whole sixth grade year at a new school, I had like no friends. I remember Connor's actually in here. That summer after my sixth grade year, I hung out with one person one time and it was Connor Atkins. That was my summer. So it was rough. Going into seventh grade, I made new friends, but they just weren't good influences. They were a lot like my older brother. See, I grew up with like forming like anger problems because of the way my like family acted towards me out of like defense. And so people just really thought it was funny to like tick me off. And so even my closest friends would, I mean, just antagonize and like really put me down and often get physical with me just to get a rise out of me because it was funny. And I just thought that's what relationships were supposed to be like. I thought that's what friendship was supposed to look like. So yeah, I surrounded myself with some really poor friends. Going into middle school into eighth grade is when we all got hooked on nicotine. It's when we first started smoking weed together. I didn't smoke a lot. I was terrified my older brother would find out and beat me up because he told me he would. Because he sort of threw his life away for weed, but I didn't smoke a ton, but when I did, it was when I was at my lowest points. It was in middle school when I first started struggling with anxiety and depression and just dealing with all that pain. I just constantly found a habit of throwing myself into toxic relationships and friendships. Even as like a middle schooler, like eighth grade, the girl I decided to date was just like awful towards me. And would like, she once told her friend, who then told me, that she specifically said she liked it when I cried. So she would lie and create stories and stuff. And even at 14 years old, we were way too physical with one another. And it was just a dangerous path. And dude, when I tell you guys, like eighth grade was when, even though I'm literally 14, it was when I was just so depressed that I would look for anything to make me happy. And I tried to find that happiness in broken, toxic relationships. Like, and it just didn't work. It didn't. And you know, I knew a ton about the Bible even at that age, but I didn't know Jesus. I didn't know a thing about him. And so growing up with, you know, an alcoholic mom who targeted me and when she got drunk and a dad who was hardly there and siblings who I felt like hated me and friends who were awful to me, it was just like, dude, what do I have to live for here? You know, I was introduced actually to pornography at like, I think 8 or 9 years old. And that created an addiction that I struggled with up until early this year that I've finally overcome. But like something that stuck with me and dragged me down and brought me to my lowest points for around a decade. Yeah, just the people I surrounded myself just really put me down. That's when I got saved, right at my lowest point. I was in Mexico my second year on that trip. And I remember one night, I got down on my knees and prayed for the first time. And I was just in the dirt, middle of Mexico, and just crying out to God and saying, like, I can't do it anymore. Like, I can't handle this. And I remember that week I've been praying, like, God, like, I feel like you want to do something with me, but I don't know what it is. And I just poured my little heart out and sobbed and just said, like, God, like, I can't do this. And it was in that moment where I was literally just sobbing there, crying, listening to worship music blasting, and just saying, God, I give everything to you. Like, I give myself, I give my pain, I give my sin. I hand it all over to you because I'm not strong enough to handle this anymore. And that's what happened. He took my life out of my hands and he said, you know what? You're my child now, and I'm gonna hold you here, and I'm gonna handle this. And it was that moment where I'm not gonna say like I had like some crazy supernatural experience, but that was the first time I felt the presence of God. And when I tell you, I've never felt comfort like that in my life. Where it felt like he was just like sitting next to me, clinging onto me and saying, it's gonna be okay. Like, and from then on, I was like, this is it. This is where my life belongs. Like, I knew from that moment I wanted to go into ministry. I knew from that moment that I would follow Jesus for the rest of my life. And I still am, but I'm still struggling. And something that you wouldn't anticipate is that the hardest battles I've had to face were while I was Christian. The lowest points of depression have been while I was Christian. The strongest thoughts of suicide have been after I was saved. The moments of greatest loneliness, of darkness, have been while I was saved. And they don't tell you that. You don't anticipate that. You think you pray that prayer of salvation, you give your life to Jesus, and now your pain doesn't exist anymore. And every time you feel pain, you can hand it off to Jesus, and he won't let you struggle with it. That's just not the case. It's not. But what it has taught me is that I need him. Every hour, I need him. Every moment, I need him, because I really cannot get through this life on my own. And I wasn't made to. You weren't made to. Like, we weren't made to struggle through this life on our own. We weren't. I mean, you go back to Genesis and look that Adam and Eve were in perfect community with God. And when they violate that, he says, well, now you're going to suffer because you're going to exist in a way that you weren't created to. Like, we weren't made for sin. And it brings on so much freaking pain. And I've made a lot of stupid decisions since I got saved. Like I said, I struggled with pornography until earlier this year. Like, you wouldn't expect that from the guy who was preaching the gospel every Tuesday night and reaching thousands of people. But that was like a daily battle, having to overcome that. And it freaking hurt so much. And you wouldn't expect it from me, most people, when I tell them this, that like, even in my highest, most spiritual moments, I was get off a live stream and sit in my room and sob because I was just in so much pain. Like, my darkest moments have been since I got saved. I've lost friends, countless friends. I mean, going into freshman year, that group of friends I had, I said, you know what? God literally dragged me away from them. Like, he was like, you don't have a choice in this matter. I was, the only thing that kept me to them was playing football. And I was so stuck to it. I went to Mexico on that mission trip and I broke my arm and I couldn't play. Like, I couldn't go to the practices, so I couldn't play it. So I didn't talk to them all summer. And so I went into freshman year with no friends, found Christian friends that I had, started a Bible study with those guys. Beginning of sophomore year, they all dropped me. I had no friends again. I had three friends that I really clung to. And like, they just sort of walked out on me. I still connect with them and I still talk to them, but like, I never felt so alone in my life. And all I had was Jesus. There was a moment last year where like, I was just so angry and so sad and just dealing with so much that like, I remember I snuck out of my house. I had just gotten into a huge fight with my parents. I snuck out of my house and I just walked down the road and it was pitch black and I was walking my neighbor and I remember just yelling out and being like, God, where are you? Because everyone else is gone. Where are you? And like, bro, I just like cried in my parents' arms that night and just poured everything out to them. And I don't know, man. What I've learned over time is that like, all I need is him. And I have had to learn that the hard way. Like, I promise you, even just this year, I told some friends and my dad a few months ago, I think 6 or 7 months ago, that I wanted to write a book because I love, love, love writing. And I told them I wanted to write about being satisfied in Christ alone. And I was like, you know, I know I could get this from the Bible, but there's not a lot of like personal experiences I could throw into this book. And I was just praying like, God, I just want you to reveal to me like what you want me to write. And so I planned out the book and I was like, here's the theological concepts I want to talk about. But then God really taught me like what it meant to be satisfied with him alone. I sort of wrote about this in my post a couple months ago, but he first showed me that I have to be satisfied with just him, that like I can lose everything and having him will be enough. And then I learned that having everything without him is never enough. Like, the hyper-spiritual Elijah Lamb that you think you know is not always me. When I fell into a depth of depression, when I gained more followers and had more money for merchandise, and I had a relationship with a girl who I should not have been with, and I had more and more friends that were leading me down dark paths, even just this year as a Christian, fell into that and learned the hard way. Jesus, none of this satisfies me. None of it. This went on for months. And I just said, you know what, God, like, I need you and you alone. And so he has taught me through before I was Christian and the moments where I came into salvation and realized how great he was. And through this walk, 3 years that I've walked with him, that he has showed me, Elijah, you need me. And that's it. That he'll give me other things. He'll bless me in other ways. But so long as I just have him, it's okay. And so now when I look at my struggles with like mental health and other stuff, like, I don't look at that and feel ashamed or guilty. Like, homie, I see a therapist and I'm proud of it. Like, I don't care, bro. I go to somebody to talk about my problems because I'm unraveling years of trauma. Like, it's the way it is. I mean, you grow up with feeling like your parents don't love you and feeling like, dude, like, when I tell you, I talked about this the other night, but like, I was at camp 1 year and I had to realize, holy crap, like, my idea of love is wrong. I have the note, like, this camp, the way they did it was, you know, you could write a note for a random camper and they gave it to him. But I have the note I read that made me just, like, at like 15 years old, just sob and cry out and just say, like, God, I've had it wrong this whole time. I have no idea what love is supposed to look like, because every image of love I had up until that point was so ridiculously wrong. Every single one. Because everyone who made me feel like I wasn't enough for them, everyone who made me feel like I could never earn their love, told me that they love me. Like, everyone who made me feel useless and unwanted, they told me that they loved me. And so I thought that's what love was. And I had to unlearn and relearn that that's not the way Jesus loves. That his love is perfect and unconditional. And that's not the way he wants me to love other people. And like, bro, he broke me down and revealed to me how much pain I was holding on to. And that was like a year and a half ago. And I'm still unraveling and handling all of this. You know, but what I can tell you is that no matter how much pain has come since that day I got saved, I would not do it any other way. And I don't think I would have had the option to. Like, I genuinely believe I would have taken my own life. I say that with all certainty, that I would not be alive if it were not for the love of Jesus Christ and the movement of the Holy Spirit in my heart. And so again, as much pain as I faced following Christ has always and will always be enough. Jesus is all that I need. And he's all that you need. He's what you were created for. And so every ounce of pain is worth it for the glory of Christ. And so that's why I can look at my story and look at my pain that I've been through and say, you know what? It's okay, Jesus. You gave me that. You gave me that for your glory. Just like the blind man, just like how you let Lazarus die so that you could glorify yourself in raising him again. Like, you gave me this pain so I could share it and your name can be glorified, because who looks good at the other end of the story? Jesus Christ looks good at the other end of this story. When I show you my weakness and I get vulnerable and show you how little I am, how weak I am, how sinful I am, that in reflection with how great the God is that I serve and how great his mercy is for me, he looks good at the other end of this story. You don't see my goodness, you see his holiness, because I am nothing but a failure at the end of the day. But Jesus has raised me from the dead. That he has been with me to crucify my flesh and make me new. And every day I walk with him. I wouldn't do it any other way. That's all for my story. I think Cameron's up. I love y'all. I'm going to mute myself now.
What's up, everybody? My name is Cameron. I'm originally from Kentucky. I have two older brothers. And both my parents are pastors. And so... I grew up in church, and I was literally in church like every day. Like, when people say, oh, I went to church every day, like, I feel like sometimes they exaggerate, but I was legit in church like every day. So I felt like religion was just forced on me. It was just a forced religion. Like, I couldn't actually like get to know who Jesus was, because I was just like, this is forced on me. And then growing up in my household, I was actually verbally and physically abused by my mom. And so
for me, when we would go to church and I would see my mom serving in every way that she could, and I would see like her loving on people and even loving on kids and stuff. But then when I would get home, then she would call me stupid and she would call me fat, and I was getting whooped across my back, and I was going through it. And so I just said to myself, like, man, if this is what Jesus is, I don't want it. Like, if this is who our Lord and Savior is, and that's not what I want for myself. And so, yeah, I tried to find comfort in everything else, because like, I can't find it in my family. I can't find it in the church. So I'm going to find comfort in something else. And so going into middle school, I was introduced to pornography. I went through a lot of bullying. I was trying to find friends. I was trying to fit in everywhere. And I found myself feeling like I couldn't fit anywhere. I really couldn't. I couldn't be who I was. And I would literally go from school and get bullied from school, and then I would come home and get bullied at home. And man, it was tough, because it was like, I had my dad there. My dad said he was like my best friend. And I had my brothers there. One of my brothers has cerebral palsy. And so I was always taking care of him and stuff, but like no one ever like helped me. And I felt like I had no help. I felt like I had no one. And so because of that, whenever I would look in the mirror, I hated the person looking back at me. I could never find comfort. I could never find peace. And so I was just like, man, I'm worthless. And so that slipped into me struggling with depression, struggling with suicidal thoughts, struggling with just feeling like I was like worthless. I wasn't worthy of anything. I wasn't worthy of love. I wasn't worthy of friends. I wasn't worthy of anything. And so, man, living in Kentucky, I got suspended from school. I started fighting. I just had hate in my heart. I had a lot of anger in my heart. And so now I'm homeschooled, eighth grade. And I remember just being home, and every day it was like another struggle. I had a tutor, and I would go to this tutor, and when I would leave, I remember she would go to my mom, and she would be like, honestly, you need to just let him know that he should work at McDonald's for the rest of his life, or he should find something to do, because he'll never be smart enough to do this. And I was like, man, it's another area of someone that doesn't believe in me, another area where I'm not loved. And suicide started to kick in really heavy, to the point where it was like one day I was ready to attempt, and my father had back surgery, so he had a lot of heavy medicine around the house. And so I had a handful of pills in my hand, and I remember I heard, I'm not done with you, I have a plan for you. And I didn't know that was the voice of God. I don't know what the voice of God is at this point. So it's just kind of like, this is probably my mom or somebody, so I'm scared. And so like, I tossed me. We moved to Lexington, Kentucky. It was my senior year of high school, and I remember we were going to this church. And to me, it was like, all people are fake, and I'm just forced into another situation. And yeah, we're going to this church, and the pastor's son immediately was like, he beelined for me, and he was like, yo, bro, like, we should hang out more. Like, you should come to youth. We should do this. And I was just kind of like, I mean, that's your job. You're the pastor's son, so of course you're going to do that, right? And he would literally invite me all the time. He would literally be like, yo, Cam, you should come. And I would always lie. I would always be like, yo, like, I got chores, I got something to do or whatever. And I remember one day he texted my mom, and then he was like, is Cameron doing anything? Is he busy? And she said, no. Then he texted me, and he was like, yo, bro, are you busy? And I said, yeah. And he was like, no, I just texted your mom. Like, I'm on the way, bro. Like, you're coming to church. And I was like, all right, babe, I'll just go. So I went, and everybody was like real nice. It was really cool, but it kind of felt fake to me. So I was just like, eh, like, I don't know. But I don't know. It was, I felt a peace about it. And it was weird. So I wanted to be standoffish, but I still felt this peace about it. They had this thing, and they have like this huge concert. And so they had like Tadashi come out and Family Force 5. I don't know if y'all remember Family Force 5 or y'all rock with them. But they had also had, yeah, I see the chainsaw. But they also had Matthew West. So I remember I was in this concert, and it's the first time I ever heard Christian rap. And I was like, he was all right. It was kind of corny, but whatever. Like, and then Family 4-5 came up, and I was like, they got a lot of energy. That was a lot, but it was cool. Like, and then Matthew West came up, and he started talking about like forgiveness, and he did like his song or whatever. But I felt like I had this moment where I felt like I was supposed to forgive my mom, and I was supposed to forgive all these people that had hurt me and stuff. And so I was like, I mean, I guess we could do it. So I did it. And then I just felt like this weight off of me. I was like, oh, this is cool. Like, this is dope. Like, wow. Then he started talking about being a child of the one true king. And he had that song, Child of the One True King, and he was just kind of like talking into it. But then he just starts talking about identity and the importance of like knowing who you are in Christ and all this other stuff. And I had this moment where like I closed my eyes and I opened them back up and nobody was in the room. It was literally still Matthew West on stage. And I felt like he was just looking at me and I felt his hand on my shoulder. And I just started hearing a voice say like, I've always loved you. I've always chased after you. In those moments where you were crying out in your room, like I was right there. And like, I just broke down, man. I fell to my knees and I started like praying and crying out. And I like, that was the first time that I felt like I heard the Lord's voice. And it was really cool. So from that moment, I was like, I mean, I believe in God, but like people are still fake. So like, God, we good, but like, I don't rock with people. And so I still had this hardened heart towards people, hardened heart towards, I mean, even really the Lord, but it was just kind of like, that was a cool moment. Months later, the head pastor actually had an affair with our worship leader and it like divided the church completely. And so for me, I was just kind of like, this is exactly what I'm used to. Church people are fake and this is not worth it. So I'm just going to go do my own thing. I left. I still kind of like read my Bible every so often. I went to like little camps here and there, but the extent of my relationship with God was I would sin all week and I would party and try to hook up with girls and do whatever. And then I would read my Bible on Saturday. I would go to church on Sunday sometimes if I wasn't hungover or whatever. And then I would repent and then that was it. And I was doing that for years. While I was working at this factory, I got a call from my mom and she told me that the nurse that was taking care of my brother, Blair, the one that has cerebral palsy, was actually abusing him. And she called me from work because she knows my anger issues. And so that's why she did that perfectly. But I was just like, no, like he needs someone to take care of him. So I quit my job. And I went and started taking care of my brother. I was his nurse. And so it was like 24/7. I was hanging out with him and it was cool. And I remember one day it was a God thing, obviously, but I just kind of was like looking at Facebook and I had a bunch of people blocked on there. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna go through and unblock people because it seems like it's like petty or whatever. So I go through and I'm unblocking people. And there was this girl that I almost dated. Her name is Cassidy. And I unblock her. And as soon as I unblock her, she messages me. And she was like, Cam, like, bro, I miss you. God put you in my heart. He told me to message you. And just kind of like apologize for everything that happened. We had like a falling out. And she was just like, man, like you've been really on my heart. And so like, I would love to see you. I'm coming in town and I'm going to be with like my school of ministry and it's going to be dope. So you should come pick me up. So I was like, okay, bet. So I picked her up. All of them seemed weird. And so I was like, I'm just going to stay in my car. I'm not going to interact with none of them. She gets in the car and she just starts talking about this school of ministry. She's talking about Atlanta. She's talking about everything that she's doing and worship. And she's like, you sing. I know you sing. I know you like this. And like, you would love it. You should come. And so I was just kind of like, okay, yeah, sure. Maybe one day, I don't know, like, I'm just giving you the runaround so you can stop talking or whatever. She left, and every day she would message me, and she'd be like, yo, you should come to campus days. Like, campus days is free. You should come. And it gets to about two or three weeks before, and I finally was just like, hey, I don't have the money. I don't have any time off because I'm taking care of my brother, and I don't have a way down there because my car wouldn't work. All of those were lies. But I was just like, whatever I could do to get her off my back, I would say. So that same day, I go outside to my mailbox and I had a check in the mail for me for like $1,000. And that's never happened before. And I was just like, okay, that's kind of weird, whatever. I go inside and tell my mom about it. And she was like, by the way, I have time off of my job. So if you have anything that you want to do during this time period, you can go do that because I can be here to take care of Blair. And the time period that she talked about was literally the campus visit that she invited me to. And I was just like, okay, God, like, okay. And so then I talked to my friend and I was like, man, I feel like God is really trying to push me to go to this campus visit thing. And I don't know if I'm supposed to go to this school or what, but I feel like I'm supposed to go. And my friend was like, bro, I have off time. I literally was about to take a vacation. I didn't know what I was going to do. So I have off time. If you want to go, I'll literally take you. And so every excuse that I made, every lie that I told, literally, like, God wiped all of them. And so I was just like, all right, bet. Like, I guess I'm going to go to this thing. So I go to this school, and I just had this amazing experience. And, like, I had never worshipped the way that I worshipped. Like, it was so free. And, like, I wasn't thinking about anybody. Like, I didn't have a hardened heart towards people. I just felt this moment where it was literally just me and God. And I literally felt like I was just, like, sitting in front of him. And it was just, like, so much freedom. And, like, I got to jump around and run around, and I wasn't worried about anybody. And I was met with open arms, and people just loved me. And I had never felt love like that before. And my friend was like, yo, this dude, he's about to preach. He's one of the, like, best preachers I know. And he preaches this message, and he talks about the kingdom, and he talks about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I was just like, I mean, I've heard people preach, bro. Like, it's not that deep. Like, don't try to hype him up. Like, relax. And so we get into it, and this man opened, like, Holy Spirit was literally just talking to me the entire time that this man was talking. And he broke it down about just, like, how the Bible is not about us, and, like, how much Jesus loves us, and we're saved by his grace, and just all these things. And, like, the way that he illustrated it, I just felt like, I felt like Jesus was just sitting next to me, like, this is what I've been trying to tell you. Like, this is what I've been trying to show you, that your life is not your own. Like, I get glory from your story and stuff like that. And so, like, man, like, I had this moment where I was just like, God, like, I want this. Like, I really do want this. And so I'm sitting there. I'm crying out. I'm sitting in a corner. And I'm literally bawling my eyes out. And I remember God began to speak to me. And he was just like, I want you. And so I was like, God, you can have it. Like, you can have my addiction to pornography. You can have, like, alcohol, you can have all of these things, like, you can have it. And God was like, I want your family. And I was like, you can have it. Like, you can have my mom, you can have my dad, you can have my friends, you can have all of those things. And he was like, I want your brother, I want Blair. And I was like, no, you can't have Blair. And he was like, he was mine before he was ever yours, and I will love him more than you ever could. And so, like, do you love me? Do you want me? Am I good enough for you to go and do what I have for you? And so, like, I came home and I talked to my brother, and I was just like, I gotta go. Like, I gotta go and do this. And I want you to know, it's not because I don't love you, but it's because I love the Lord so much more. And he has a plan for me, and I have to go do it. And I remember, he can't talk, he's nonverbal, but I remember he looked at me, he started to cry, and he looked up and he smiled. And, like, in that moment, like, I felt so much peace that the Lord is like, I'm gonna take care of him. And something that Elijah hit on that was, like, really key for me, that, like, I noticed, is, like, I thought from there it was good. Like what he said, like, it, God would just take care of all my stuff and I could just put it at his feet. But no, like, I've literally faced some of the worst hardships and trials being a Christian that I was in the world. And man, like, when I came down here, I felt like God owed me something. Like, when I moved to Atlanta, I came to the school, and my brother was in the hospital and he almost died. I found out my mom has breast cancer. Like, a bunch of just crazy things started happening. And, like, every relationship, I was in toxic relationships, man. I was in a ministry school, and I would literally go from a worship session, and then I would go have sex with a girl. Like, legit, like, just toxic and doing the dumbest stuff. And I finally kind of, like, straightened that stuff out and stopped doing it. But then I got to a point where I got super cocky with God, and I was like, you owe me. And God was like, what? Like, I owe you what? And I was like, you owe me a wife. You owe me a ministry. You owe me this stuff. Like, I was obedient to you. I gave up everything for you. Like, even when my brother was about to die, I stayed down here and I did homeless ministry and I did at-risk youth ministry. And I found out my mom has cancer, and I'm still staying here and doing this team stuff. And so it's like, you owe me. And the Lord is like, I don't owe you anything because I gave you everything. Like, I gave you everything. And so I don't owe you anything. And, like, from there, like, I think it was about a year ago that I really had to get into this spot where I was like, God really doesn't owe me. And, like, he asked me, he was like, if I didn't give you anything, like, if you never got the ministry you wanted, like, my biggest goal, like, my biggest dream is to be a husband and a father. And then after that is to do music and to do ministry. And so the Lord was like, if I never gave you anything, if I never gave you music ministry, if I never gave you a wife, if I never gave you a family, am I good enough for you? Like, is that good enough for you? Like, a relationship with me, is that good enough for you? And I said, no. Like, the answer was no. That wasn't good enough for me. And God was like, okay, so that was good. And I was like, I don't think that's good. But God was like, well, no, it's good because I can't begin to heal where you pretend to be. So when you choose to be vulnerable and you choose to, like, be real with me and tell me where you're at, that's when we can work. And so, like, I literally took a year and wasn't talking to anybody. I was talking to this girl, and I was to the point where I was like, honestly, I could marry this girl. And it was healthy and stuff. But the only thing was I found my peace in her. I found love and I found joy in her. I wasn't finding that in the Father. And I had to take a year to really, like, check myself, to really, like, read my word, not for what I could get out of it, not taking the context all out of it and just kind of like reading Jeremiah 29:11 just so I can hear that he has a plan for me, but like actually reading it and studying it and actually applying it to me that I could hide it in my heart that I wouldn't sin against him and that I could actually know God. Like when it says, like, in the beginning was the word and the word was with God and the word was God, like you can't say that you know God if you're not reading his word. And so I was like, man, like, I got to study this word. I got to get in here, not for what I can get out of it, but for you, like to get to know you, get to know your heart for your people. And like, man, like, if I could just wrap this up with anything, it's just to say that Jesus is literally everything and he's good enough. Like he's good enough. He's better than addiction. He's better than the little things of this life. Like, man, all of these things fade away. But he's eternal. Like he will forever be there. Like he never leaves you nor forsake you. And so, like, yeah, that's my story. And yeah, Jesus is my everything, and he's good enough. Even in the trials, even in the tribulations, like he will forever be good enough for me.
That was awesome, Cameron. Bro, so there's a part of my testimony I always forget to share. And it's that my parents aren't alcoholics anymore. And, like, my family and I's relationship has been totally restored and reconciled. Like, my dad's an elder at my church now. My mom reads her Bible more than anyone I know. And, like, my home life is good for the past few years. I forget to share that part, which is, like, an amazing testament of God's reconciling power. I just wanted to let y'all know that, like, dude, he's totally changed all of that. But, dude, Cameron, you killed that. Connor, you're up. Love you. Okay.
Hi, I'm Connor, the one that Elijah talked about in his testimony. And my story is going to be a little bit different from Cameron's and Elijah's because I've always grown up in a Christian household. Like, my dad is the pastor of the church that I attend, and he actually, like, founded it a month before I was born. So it's kind of like all that I've really known. I accepted Christ somewhere around the age of 7 or 8 because it really seemed like something that I should do instead of something that I wanted to do. Because of one of my leaders, I started serving at my church in, like, 3rd or 4th grade, just because it was something to keep me preoccupied. Like, I was, like Cameron was saying, I was always at church. And though I really did believe the gospel, and I really do believe that I accepted Christ that day, my heart just wasn't in the right place because I was going through the motions. My relationship with the Lord was limited to the walls of the church, really. I never read my Bible. I only really prayed when I wanted something from God. And it wasn't good. It wasn't working for me. I believed that I was the center of my life at the time. I believe that I was good enough to be self-sufficient and that I could do it on my own. And I thought I had the whole world in the palm of my hand. But that all kind of changed when I went into middle school because I just became so anxious and so worried. And it was several different things going on in my life because, like, I was growing up, the future terrified me. At the time, my brother was leaving for college, and that was something that really scared me because I share a room with him. So that was just another big shift in my life that I just didn't feel like I was prepared for. Like I said, I was so anxious. Every single day, it felt like there was a weight on my chest because of my circumstances. And I never really considered myself to be good enough. I always panicked about the future, and that was probably stemming out of the whole thing of I can do it on my own. I didn't need Jesus. I had no trust in the Lord. And because of that, I had no hope for the future. Every single day for me at that time, it felt like it was a new challenge. It was a new struggle. I couldn't ever fall asleep at night. It was just, it was a rough period of my life. I would always be watching TV, YouTube. I was always on my phone trying to do something and preoccupy myself because I didn't want to leave myself alone with my thoughts. I didn't want to give my mind time to think because it would remember the pain I was going through, the anxiety, the worries about the future that I had. And it was a bad time in my life, but I wasn't ever going to let anyone see that. Like I was saying before, I was serving at my church. I was a pastor's kid, so I felt like I had a little bit of a reputation to uphold, and I didn't want to tell anybody what I was going through just because I held my cards close to the vest. Like I said, I didn't really think about the future much at this time, but at that time, I really, really wanted to be a doctor. That's partially because my dad, like, really pushed that on me. I mean, didn't even push it on me, but he supported it because I think I came to him with the idea originally, and he really supported that idea because, obviously, I mean, that's a good career choice. But it was also just because I wanted to have material things. I wanted to be wealthy. I wanted to make a lot of money. I was hoping that that would fix my issues. So my life was kind of a wreck. I wasn't focused on Jesus at all, ever. I was just focused on myself. What was going to be best for me? What was going to benefit me the most? But this really all changed, at summer camp right before my ninth grade year. This was still to this day, like one of the best summer camps I've ever gone to. The speakers were amazing. The worship was fantastic. They had like super, super fun events and stuff like that. All my friends were there. However, I think it was like on the fourth day of the camp or something like that. It was coming towards the end of the camp. I was in worship and I don't even remember what song it was, but I just remember breaking down in tears because right then and there, I felt God move in my heart. And I knew that something was drawing me towards a life of ministry and specifically being a pastor. And that was new to me because my dad was a pastor and I'm the most extroverted of all my siblings. So people were always like, oh, are you going to be a pastor one day like your dad, or are you going to do this? And I really just, I was against it. I was pushing back against that. I said, I really don't want to do that. That's not the life for me. My dad does it well. It works for him, but that's not what I want. I want to have things. And that just being a pastor didn't seem like it was the best route to do that for me. But that, like I said, that night during worship, it all changed. It struck me that there's really nothing in my life, like for me, that I can do that would be better for me to do than devote my life to a life of ministry and a life for Christ. And ever since that whole night, I don't know how to explain it to you. I really don't know what it was, but my life has changed. I mean, my anxieties, my worries, I mean, not all my struggles are gone. I still go through things. I still go through pain. I still struggle with things. But just my heart was completely renewed by the Lord. I trust I trust the Lord wholeheartedly with my heart. And so that was my turning point in my testimony. Ever since then, I've been like serving the church. I've been more involved. And the biggest thing for me was not that, like, you know, like some of the other testimonies that we've already heard, that, you know, I wasn't involved in the church, or I wasn't doing this. But the thing for me is, like, I was there. God was with me. He was all around me. He was right there, but I was blind to it. He was right in front of my face. He was giving me opportunities. I missed out on chances to grow. I missed out on chances to benefit the church, all because I was being selfish. I was saying, I can do this. I saw what God did for my church, for my family specifically, since my dad was a pastor. And I looked him right in the eyes and I said, that's great. Thank you for doing that, but that's not what I'm going to do. I don't need that. I don't need you, because I can do it on my own. I can do that by myself. But to sum the whole thing up, if you find yourself in a place of like being a lukewarm Christian, or you find yourself in the situation where, yeah, sure, you attend church on Sundays, but you're not really, you don't have a relationship with the Lord, but you just practice it. It's your religion, but it's because something your parents did. I would seriously encourage you to get involved in your churches, to build a relationship with the Lord, to read your Bible, not because it's something that you should do, pray not because it's something that you should do, but it's because it's something that will help you grow in your relationship with the Lord. So, my testimony is not very long, but that's basically all I got.
What's up? So I'm Garrett. This is actually the first time that I've shared my testimony from start to finish with anyone ever. I take the back. There's one person, but in a weird way, he's part of my testimony. So I don't really know if that counts, but I grew up in a Christian household. Both my parents are Christians. Grandparents are Christians. My grandpa, my grandma are two of the strongest Christians I have ever met in my life. Like, my grandfather, you could sit and listen to him for hours and still have and still be left with just more questions. But the problem was, I never believed. You know, my mom, she did the children's ministry at the church that I grew up in. My father was an elder. I never believed. And that was just kind of how my life went all through elementary. There was nothing really eventful. I lived a normal life. And then sixth grade, where everyone's life starts to turn upside down for one reason or another. For me, what that was my introduction to pornography. Excuse me. It grabbed a hold of me, and it grabbed a hold of me very, very quickly. Something that I wish I would have addressed from the beginning, but I didn't. Another thing that happened to me was the relationship with my parents began to deteriorate. I have not the best relationship with my parents even now. I would fight with my father almost nightly, get into screaming matches. It was rough. One of the things with that is there's this weird trend in the men in my family that we all come from a long line of abuse. My father's never laid a hand on me or my brother. But for that reason, I like to call him emotionally disabled. Doesn't show a lot of emotion in any situation. And that hurt as a kid growing up, like never really hearing I love you, never really getting a hug, never hearing I'm proud of you. It stung. And outside of that, middle school, as far as actually being in middle school, it wasn't that bad. I had friends, not a lot of drama, surprisingly. Then freshman year came, and this is when things started to really suck. At the beginning of freshman year was when I first started to realize that I was attracted to men as well as women. And that was something that I did not want to acknowledge. That was something that I just shoved to the back of my mind. I'm like, I am not even going to address this. In part, it was like, there's no way my parents would even accept this or anything. I graduated from a class of 45 kids in a small town school in Iowa. So you just, even if you weren't Christian in that school, you pretended to be because it was just easier. That's what I was doing. And so I just shoved it to the back of my mind. I'm like, I'm not going to acknowledge this. That was also about the time where I started becoming emotionally closed off. What I mean by that is over the next few years, I would develop something that is known as clinical narcissism. What this is where either the brain chooses to not respond to emotions or the brain's receptors to those emotions get closed off. And as a result of that, I started to deal with a lot of identity issues. I didn't know who I was. From the time of freshman year to the end of my senior year, I was the goth, I was the skater, I tried being a jock at one point, I was the band kid, the theater kid, anything and everything you could think of, I did. Because I didn't know who I was supposed to be, who I wanted to be, anything. That even transferred to the activities I was a part of. When I tell you I did everything from dance team to wrestling and everything in between, I did everything. Because I wanted to figure out who I was and I couldn't do it. I have like notes in front of me because I'm going to go all over the place. Sophomore year came around, and sophomore year was when I kind of hit the peak of what I like to call my emo phase. What I did was I decided that, hey, people don't really like me. So I'm just going to decide that I don't like anybody because, you know, it's going to be cool to be the edgy kid who just kind of hates everyone. Like I'm going to be out in my own little world. Did not work. Because deep down, I didn't hate everybody. I deeply, deeply wanted to be loved. I deeply wanted people to like me. And it didn't work. And that confused me. I didn't understand why people didn't like me. You know, I would go home and I didn't feel any sort of acceptance from my family whatsoever. You know, I'd go to school and I had only a couple of friends. And even those friends were incredibly, incredibly toxic. And now we're at junior year. Junior year was when I became a bully. I decided that, you know what? If I hate everyone and everyone hates me, I'm going to give them a reason to hate me. That was also the point where I stopped feeling a lot of emotions altogether. Around junior year, I stopped feeling sad. I stopped feeling remorse. I stopped feeling enthusiasm. I stopped feeling joy. There was a lot of emotions that I did not feel. And looking back, I was not even aware of it. I had no idea. All I knew was that I was just angry all the time. I was either angry or I felt nothing. And as a result, I did a lot of things that I'm really not proud of. I hurt a lot of people. That was when I started getting into partying also. I look back at junior year and there's a lot of emotions that come over me. And so we finish up junior year. I'm one of the most hated people in my school. I have hurt people. I'm partying. I'm drinking. I almost leave my house twice. I almost move out twice as a junior, just trying to escape my home life because I can't stand being around my family anymore. And I go to this one camp. It was odd. It was what's called a worldview camp. So if you don't know what a worldview is, it's basically the way in which you apply your biblical theology or any sort of philosophical ideas to the way in which you see the world. And so the purpose of that camp was to take the faith that you already had, break it down, and build it back up. Because like I said, I faked being a Christian. I pretended because it was just easier. I went to church every Sunday, every Wednesday night I was at youth. I never believed though. And so I went to this camp and I left just feeling weird because the way in which they had presented everything to me made me believe in a logical sense that there has to be a God. There has to be, because so many different things don't line up if there's not. You know, I never really believed in evolution because nothing made sense with that either, but I couldn't wrap my mind around the Christian God either. So around my senior year, I kind of fell into what is known as a deist. I believed in one all-powerful monotheistic God, but I wasn't a Christian by any means. Another thing that I did that started my senior year was I sat down, I pulled out a notebook, and I wrote down all of the traits that I knew about myself, and I wrote down all the traits that people know about me. For example, I wrote down that I was a bully. I wrote down that I was on dance. I wrote down anything and everything I could about myself. And I remember sitting there and looking at it and thinking, what do I have to do to be well-liked? What do I have to do to get that validation that I want so desperately? And it clicked. I can't be a bully to everyone. I have to be a bully to the people everyone already hates. And so my senior year, I went from being one of the most hated people in my school to being just a few votes off from being on homecoming court in the span of just a few months. How I did that was I found the people who were hated most in my school and I bullied them relentlessly and without remorse. Because like I said, at this point, I didn't feel remorse. I validated every action that I did. I justified every wrong that I committed. There was a point where there was a girl who I used to be friends with. And at this point, everyone hated her for a series of other reasons. But my plan in its entirety was I wanted to bully this girl into killing herself. That was my plan. And that was something I tried to carry out to end. When I say I deeply despise the person that I was, I mean that in the fullest capacity that I can mean. My senior year was also when I accepted the fact that I was bisexual. I started, sending nudes, searching out men, sexting. Even to the point where I would go on disgusting, vile apps and find older men and blackmail them. I would find out who they were and threaten to leak information about them. Because like I said, everything that I did, I justified. I was like, I deserve this. Or this is okay, or this is what happened to me, so this has to happen to other people. I'm ashamed of who I was. There's not a lot of words that I can really use. So my senior year goes by. I'm now living actively bisexual. I'm not out. People in my school don't know. It's something I still kept private because, again, small town school, it's not the best move. I just was not who I should have been. But anyway, like I said, senior year gets done and it's time for camp. At this point, my family had left the church that we had previously been attending for a series of reasons. It's not really important. But when the invitation went out to reserve a spot on the bus to go to the camp, my mom still got the email. So I signed up, I got my spot because I still wanted to go to camp. Camp was fun to me. Even though I wasn't a Christian, I threw on the Christian face. I went to camp, I had fun. We get to camp. It is Monday morning and I just feel kind of weird. I can't really place my finger on what it is, but I go to the lodge, one of the lodges, and I'm just there alone, and I'm sitting there, and I start getting emotional, and I'm scared right now because I don't get emotional. I don't cry. I don't know what's going on. And everything that I had done over the last 3 years just came to the forefront of the mind. All of the people that I hurt, all of the things that I'd done, all the images that I had sent and received, everything was just coming to the forefront of my mind. And I'm sitting there trying to justify it. I'm like, no, they deserve this because of X, Y, Z. I deserve this because of this. They hurt me. I deserve to hurt them back. Everything. And I couldn't do it. I started crying. And now I'm scared because I'm crying. And I recognize that I don't cry. What is going on? And I'm sitting there and just having a full-on emotional breakdown, and then nothing. I felt nothing. I didn't feel sad, happy, angry, upset. It was nothing. I remember I just stared at a wall, fully aware of my actions for 2-3 hours, just sitting there. And after a while, I started to come around a little bit, and I just felt different. I could feel things. I was sad. I was remorseful. All of these things that I had not felt in years because of the things that I replicated from my father's behavior. I could feel things, and that terrified me. I remember I went and I talked to the youth pastor of the church that my family had left. And I was like, I don't know what's going on with me. I don't know. And this man, his name is Colby Allen. I love this brother with my whole heart. I was awful to him for the time that I was under him as a student, because he had come in and replaced someone that I loved. So I had lots of vile things, said nasty things about him. But he loved me regardless. And he spent time with me trying to work through things. And I remember Wednesday night came around, and for the first time, I kind of tried praying a couple of times in those first couple of days to just kind of try to figure out what was going on. And it felt like talking to nothing, you know? It would be as if I was just talking to a wall. There was no conversational aspect to it. That Wednesday night, I remember I sat up in my bunk, and I'm like, God, if you are there, if you are there, I gotta know. And I start praying, and the only way I can describe this is it felt like a wave just hit the top of my head, and just from head to toe, I don't know how to describe it. Just this energy go through me. And you know how when you have an iron deficiency, you stand up really quick and your vision just kind of like trips out? I had that, but with all of my senses. I could no longer really see. I couldn't really hear. I couldn't like feel my bunk. I had no sense of like even gravity. Like it just felt like nothing, except that I could still feel whatever it was inside of me. And then next thing I know, it's the morning. And the guy who was on the bunk next to me, I was on the bottom bunk and he was like across from me. Next morning he asked me if I was okay. And I'm like, yeah, I think I am. And he's like, oh, good, because you were like talking to yourself for 4 hours last night. And I'm like, oh, that's pretty sick. So a lot of other things happened in that week. I'm not going to talk about a lot. But that was when I accepted Jesus Christ. And everything was transformed. I remember I was sitting on the bus ride home, and I went through, deleted my Snapchat, blocked tons of numbers, deleted all of my social media. I wiped my phone clean. There was a man that I was going to meet up with the day that I got back from camp and actually lose my virginity to him. So even God's timing in retrospect to that is incredible. I almost made an awful, awful mistake that God saved me from. But this, like Elijah and Cam have met, I've mentioned, was not all that I thought it was. You know, I was like, nice. Okay, my life is going to be good now. I'm going to have a relationship with my family and my parents, and I'm no longer going to be attracted to men, and I can feel things now, and I have friendships and all these different things. And next thing I know, I'm watching porn, 3 days after all of this, and I just sat there. I'm like, what am I doing? This is not, I accepted Jesus Christ. I have this Holy Spirit inside of me. What is going on? And so I realized that my pornography addiction was still there, and I was terrified by that. What scared me even more was that I was still attracted to men, and that led to so much shame and just self-loathing. Because you hear all these amazing stories of people who are living in a homosexual lifestyle. The Holy Spirit fills them, and then they're cured. They no longer struggle with that temptation. And I would read those stories. I would listen to people like Jackie Hill Perry, and I would just think, why not me? What am I doing something wrong? Did I not actually accept Jesus Christ? And I just had so much anxiety about that. So many other areas of my life began to heal. I found myself being compassionate, you know, loving people. You know, Holy Spirit had softened my heart and fixed whatever it was that was going on inside my brain to keep me from truly experiencing life. Like, don't get me wrong, there are things that change even the way I see. I remember I almost drove off a road, like my first day back, the road right by my house, because I was just admiring the clouds. The way that I looked at the clouds with having the Holy Spirit inside of me was different. But there was still a lot of shame that I held on to, and I was afraid to admit to people. So look, for the timeline's sake, this is the summer of 2018. I accepted Jesus Christ in the summer of 2018, about 2 years ago. It was 2 years ago and 3 weeks, 2 weeks, excuse me. I did not admit to anyone that I was still struggling with pornography and same-sex attraction until 3 months ago. I held on to all of that fear and all of that anxiety and that pain and that disgust for almost 2 years after accepting Jesus Christ. You know, it was actually from a brother that I met through TikTok that after having conversations, 6-hour FaceTime calls for 3 weeks, it was in that first week after 3 or 4 calls that I was finally able to get it out to him. And he looks at me and goes, Garrett, bro, I struggle with that too. You're not alone. Dude, you aren't perverse. You aren't disgusting. He goes, you struggle with a temptation. And it was in that moment that I just felt like I could actually take a deep breath for the first time in years. You know, I from there went and confessed to a few of my close friends. I'm like, hey, these are things that I'm struggling with and I need help. You know, that youth pastor that I talked about, Colby, at this time, I'm now working under him in a church. I'm a youth ministry intern. I actually just finished up the internship. I'm working under him and I'm like, bro, this is what's going on. I don't know what to do. And I remember I had to tell him over FaceTime because I just had to do it in that moment. And the next time he sees me, he just comes up and gives me the biggest hug. He's like, Garrett, I've known for so long that there was something going on. He goes, I have prayed for you every night for almost 2 years that you would confess what is going on. He goes, bro, I love you so much. And I'm so incredibly proud of you. And with that, it's like, you know, Elijah and Cameron said, the hardest things that I went through was after accepting Jesus Christ. The times that I hated myself the most, I was in the darkest mental places, was after I accepted Jesus Christ. But I'm now able to look back and I'm able to see the way that the Holy Spirit has worked through me and in me. I'm able to see that I have hope for the first time in my life. You know, my relationship with my parents may not be what it wanted to be, but I have hope that the Holy Spirit may work through me. I have hope that Jesus Christ can fix that. I have hope and comfort in knowing that I have a Heavenly Father who far surpasses anything I could ever desire out of an earthly father. You know, I still struggle with same-sex attraction to this day, but I have hope that this is something that the Holy Spirit can heal. That is something that the Holy Spirit can use to reach other young men, because honestly, we don't talk about it enough. I have hope that even though there's times that I still go back into that mental space where I feel nothing, that there is someone who loves me. I have a father who loves me, who is going to pull me out of it each and every time. So my testimony, it's weird. It's dirty. It's messy. It's gross. And it is something that is still growing to this day. But what I get out of this is knowing that for the first time in my life, I have hope that I may not know what's going to go on tomorrow. I may not know if there's things. I don't know if I'll ever be healed of my same-sex attraction. I don't know if I'll ever have the relationship with my parents that I desire. But I know that Jesus Christ died on the cross for me, that there is a seat in heaven waiting for me. I know that I am filled with the Holy Spirit. And for that, I would go through everything again. I would do it all again just to get to this point, because this surpasses anything I could have ever imagined for my life. So, yeah, that's my testimony.
Hi, guys. I'm Abby. Can you guys hear me? Okay, cool. So I had this whole testimony planned out, and then as everyone was talking before me, I just kind of felt God putting on my heart things that I didn't write down. So if it's a little messy, I apologize. Okay, so I'm just going to start with my parents are first generation Christians. My mom grew up Jewish and was saved later in her life, and my dad was raised Catholic and gained that relationship with Christ later in his life. So they thought it was extremely important for me to be raised in a Christian household because they were not raised in such an environment. So I can't pinpoint the exact moment in my life where I accepted Christ, because I was just always surrounded by Christians and Christian influences and just learning about the Bible and the history of the Bible. But so yeah, I grew up in a Christ-centered home, and I wouldn't say I had any family problems necessarily, but yeah, I went to church, Sunday school. I even got to go to a private Christian school from kindergarten through eighth grade. And my first memory of confessing my belief in Christ was in my living room in my house when I was three. My sister led me in the sinner's prayer, but of course I was only three, and I didn't know what I was saying. So it didn't really mean anything because I couldn't make that conscious decision for myself yet. But so I grew up only just going through the motions. I believed that Jesus Christ existed, but I didn't have that personal relationship with him. It was just go to church every Sunday, pray at church, don't pray at home, read your Bible only at church or only when your mom tells you to, but never on your own when you feel led to. It was always just look like a Christian, but don't act like a Christian at home by yourself. And it wasn't until I joined my youth group that I even questioned, should I have a relationship with Christ? Because I saw the older kids, they had relationships with Christ, and I was like, that's kind of weird. Like, Jesus wants to know me. Jesus wants me to know him. He wants to have that relationship with me. So I kind of admired them, but I kind of skipped a part of my testimony. I grew up, when I was a baby, my dad heard from God that I would be a singer and that I would use my music for Christ. And so in my head, as I grew up, that was like, I'm going to be famous. I'm going to be Taylor Swift. I'm going to have all these people that love me for myself. And I took that and I became prideful in my my music and my singing. And as I went to private school, it was a Christian school, so it was supposed to be like a healthy environment, but we all know that that doesn't necessarily happen even in churches. And I began to get bullied. I was bullied, and I realized how prideful I was, so I started tearing myself down. And I overcorrected my pride, and I made it so much that I became not confident in who I was at all. I had no idea who I was as a person. I thought I was the dirt of the earth. I thought I didn't deserve anything. And so I was completely lost throughout middle school. And so when I joined youth group, I felt safe and I felt loved, because it was the first time I had experienced Christians who had true relationships with Christ that wanted to help me grow in my relationship with Christ. But to me, I wasn't taking it completely seriously. I still wasn't reading my Bible every day. I still wasn't praying. And I would go to these youth conventions, these conferences, and I would expect God to move in my life. And when he wouldn't, I would be disappointed. I'm like, God, why are you letting me down? And so this is now, I'm 16. I'm going to be a senior this year. So this is two summers ago, after freshman year, I get to go on a missions trip to Panama. And this is my first time I really get to share the gospel with people. And this is around the time that I actually started to read my Bible. I started to give God the time of day, and I started to actually build that relationship with him and that foundation with him. And I went to the missions, on the missions trip to Panama, and what we did was we went to different schools and we had assemblies where we would share Christ with the other kids. And I remember the first service that we held, my dad went on the missions trip with me. He pointed me to this girl who was crying. It was an altar call, and she was sobbing, and obviously there's a language barrier. I don't speak fluent Spanish. She didn't speak any English, and he just said, just go hug her. And I was like, that's so stupid. Why would she want a complete stranger who has no idea what she's going through to hug her? That is crazy. He's like, just do it. And I was like, sure, whatever. So I went and I hugged her. And I, even as I was hugging her, I was like, I look so stupid right now. And I walked back to my dad, and all of a sudden, as immediately right when I made eye contact with my father, I just felt a wave of the Holy Spirit, like Garrett said. It was just like, I felt like just a wave of God saying, like, you did the right thing. And I started bawling, and I had no idea why I was bawling. I was sobbing. And that was the first time I felt God's presence in my life. And it wasn't until I devoted time in my everyday life to Christ that I actually felt his presence in my life, because I just went on expecting him to move when I wasn't taking any initiative to allow him to move. And so a few experiences like that happened for the rest of that trip in Panama. And I got back, and this is the summer after, this is summer after sophomore year, so this is last summer. I'm still growing in our relationship with Christ. Of course, as they said, there's mountains and valleys, and we all go through hard times, even as Christians. And I was facing those times of temptation and just hurt and depression and anxiety. And I went to a Christian camp with my youth group last summer. And at this point, I'm still feeling not good enough. I feel like God can't use me because I'm an awful person. I thought I was so good when I was younger, when really I was an awful person, and I still am an awful person, and God can't use my music because it's not good enough. It's not good enough for him. But I was already on the worship team at my youth group anyway. I wanted to glorify him in any way that I could, and I tried my hardest. I still didn't think I was good enough. But it was one night at camp that they had an altar call for people who felt like they were being called into ministry. And that was the second time that I really, really felt God's presence in my life. It was really weird. They said, if you feel like God's calling you to be into ministry, take your shoes off and hold them up in the air as a sign to devote every step you take to Christ, and that you will say yes no matter what. And I didn't know why I felt this way, but I took my shoes off and I held them up in the air, and immediately I lost it. I started crying again, and I just knew that is what God had for my life. And I found in that moment worth and love, because before that, whenever I sang, whenever I wrote music, whenever I did anything like that, it just felt like I was doing it for myself and I wasn't good enough. But immediately after, I went back to youth group, I led worship, and it felt like I was home. And Jesus used that experience to really just put me in check and say, you're not using this talent for you. You're going to use it for me. And ever since then, that is one of the reasons I have started using my platform on TikTok to lead people into worship, because people even like Elijah Lamb, I would watch Christian TikTokers and I was like, wow, maybe I should use my platform instead of wanting to be famous. Maybe I should make Jesus famous. And so that's why I started sharing the gospel with other people and sharing my calling for worship with other people. And so just to leave you guys with one piece of advice, if you expect God to move in your life, you can't just expect him to move in your life without you taking any initiative to get to know him. Because like I like to describe God's, your relationship with God is like your relationship with any friend you ever have. You have to get to know them. You have to understand their voice. You're not going to know when a sign from God comes if you don't recognize his voice and how he moves. So until you get in your Bible and start praying, pray without ceasing, until you do that, you're not going to recognize God's voice, and you're not going to see the path that he has for you. You're not going to see when he moves in your life. It's so important to just devote every moment to Christ and to start every day, end every day, just having your life be devoted solely to Christ and not yourself. And yeah, that's it.
All right. So I was raised in the church. I was born and raised in Texas. I'm 15 years old. I'm going into my junior year. And ever since I can remember, I remember, you know, being at Sunday school. And my parents were divorced. My mother was a Christian, and my father, as far as I'm concerned, when I was a child, was an atheist. He's an agnostic now. But I was raised with a lot of doubt. And I just remember, you know, going into my fifth grade year, all of elementary, I was very innocent. I was surrounded by innocent little kids. And my fifth grade year, you know, boys started to watch porn. Girls started to become really rude. And I just remember thinking, oh, I'm growing up. People around me are getting into sin. And my sixth grade year, I battled with a lot of, I was very self-conscious of my body. I was very insecure. And I began to, you know, I felt like I lost control over my friendships. So I wanted to gain control over at least one thing in my life. So I began to starve myself. I battled with a lot of eating disorders until the end of my eighth grade year. And really going into my eighth grade year is when everything started to take a toll. I was extremely, extremely, extremely depressed. I had no understanding of the gospel. I had no understanding of God. Yet I was raised in the church, yet I was surrounded by Christians all my life. I remember just going home from school and being on my bed, looking at my ceiling, thinking how much I didn't understand life. I felt like the relationships that I was in with all the people around me were so toxic. And while I lost control of so many things in my life, I still could control what I ate. And it was very, very, it took a negative toll on my well-being. I didn't understand Christianity. I chased after experiences. And like I said, I dealt with a lot of doubt. My father used to sit me down when I was a little girl and tell me the Bible was just full of fairy tales. None of it was true. The only good thing we can take away from reading the Bible is help the poor. That's what he would tell me. So I was never certain about my belief on God. And in my eighth grade year, I just felt like I had lost so much hope. I didn't have a stable relationship with anyone. I hated myself. I couldn't stand people around me. I hated going to school. I never felt like anyone understood me. And it was really, really hard. I'm a dancer. I did dance competition. I was at dance class every day of the week except for 2 days. So I just remember not having time to like take care of myself, and having this doubt was really hard for me. And I really began to get into researching apologetics, And there was this huge turning point in my life when I came across Living Waters Ministry on YouTube. And I just got into all this stuff about proof of God. And I really got into astronomy. I love astronomy. That's why my username is Daughter of the Star Creator. And so my eighth grade year, I was sure that God existed. And I thought this was me getting on fire for God, but no, it was just part of my journey. And my freshman year, I got into this state of rebellion. I literally cussed all the time. Like, I couldn't say a sentence without five cuss words. I gossiped all the time. I judged people. I remember looking at people who were broken, who were insecure, and thinking like, oh my gosh, they're so annoying. I remember being someone who thought I was a Christian when I recognized I truly had no understanding of Christianity, of who Jesus was. As someone who I thought was a Christian, I remember, you know, going on any social media and going into people's pages and seeing like a Bible verse or seeing Jesus freak in their bio and being like, oh my gosh, so annoying. I was so judgmental, and my mindset was still toxic. I did get over my depression in a sense. I began to eat a lot again, so I was over my eating disorders, but I still was not saved. I was not born again. Like I said, I chased after experiences. I remember I was on this choir and band trip with a few of my best friends, and we were talking about all these experiences we want to have. We want to get drunk. We want to get high at least one time before we graduate. And I remember thinking, like, that's so cool. That's the teenage life. And I thought that would satisfy me. And people around me were so toxic. People were so rude. I was rude. And I remember having a conversation with one of my friends saying, I don't feel God. I don't feel God. I thought God was just like some feeling, like you literally felt high in a sense on God. I didn't understand. And I remember just being in my freshman year talking with some of my friends about how all these things we want to do before graduation. And I thought, okay, after that, you know, after I graduate, that's when I can get right with God. That's when I'll get right with God. I thought Christianity was like some moral betterment program, like how to be a good person so I can be reconciled to God. I didn't understand Christianity at all. And I remember, you know, since the beginning of my eighth grade year until before I became born again, the middle of the first semester of my sophomore year, I would pray to God every day and say, God, reveal yourself to me. I don't feel you. I believe in you. And I thought, you know, if you do exist, you forgot about me. You forgot about me. I feel like garbage. All the people around me are toxic. I've lost control over my friendships, over myself. I was just unsatisfied because I didn't understand that trying to fill this void in my soul with anything but God would leave me broken, would leave me even, in a sense, farther away from God. That's how I felt. And I really got into apologetics a lot at the beginning of my freshman year. That's after I had been on TikTok since May of 2019. And I remember finding a lot of Christian TikTokers, and I followed them because I thought I was Christian. You know, I might as well follow them. I posted a few Christian TikToks, yet I didn't have a relationship with Jesus myself. I knew of him. I didn't know him personally. But I remember just being referred to watching some sermons on YouTube. And November 26, 2019, I watched this sermon on sin. And I remember whoever was preaching was explaining how being a lukewarm Christian is like, you're just living a lie. You're a hypocrite. And when we read the book of 1 John, it talks about, like, if people claim they love God yet break his commandments, they're liars. Like, they don't have the truth in them. And that was me. And I remember just falling on my knees that night before God, saying, just being so sorry for my sin. I was so sorry. I was sick of living for myself. I was sick of going to my friends when I had problems, because they can try their hardest to be there for me, but no one can be there for me the way God is, because we were created by God for God, and I didn't understand that. But when I watched this sermon, you know, afterwards, I just fell on my knees bawling, and I was like, God, I'm sick of living for myself. God, change me. I'm sick of thinking that my relationship with you is supposed to be just some spiritual high that I go through every time I go to some church camp every year. I thought he was just this feeling. I didn't understand. But when I was presented the truth, when I was presented how awful my sin was and how there's no such thing as like a little sin that you can just get away with, like it, any sin is unrighteousness, and it separates us from the holy God. And when I understood that, I just remember being like, I am so sorry. When I learned that truth, when I understood that truth, see, I lived my entire life without a clarity of the gospel, without this clarity of what God wants for me. And once I understood that, I just remember being like, God, give me a new spirit. Make me new. I hate who I am. I hate myself. I'm terrible. I'm awful. And I was just crying so much. And I remember falling asleep crying, just praying and crying out to God. And I woke up an entirely different person. The veil had been lifted from my eyes. And no longer did I just believe God existed. I believed on God. I repented. I said, God, like, I give you my life. Like, make it obvious to me where you want to lead me. I'm sick of worrying about myself. I want you to direct my path. I want to completely trust in you. You know, Proverbs 3. Matthew 6 talks about that. And I was like, God, I just surrender myself to you. And I was still unclear about a lot of things, but starting January 2020, I understood that I have to read my Bible if I want to truly gain an intimate relationship with God. And I just remember thinking how broken I was without God, how empty I was without God, and how the gospel is not that the world will be made better. It's that the world will only get worse, but we will be saved out of it. I understood the reality of sin and how that was hell. And I wanted God. I didn't want to continue to live in my sin. I didn't want to chase after these experiences, because how I thought these experiences would fill my soul, it just left me more broken. And that was just a lie from the enemy that I believed. And when I understood it, that we're going to endure pain. If I chose God, life would get hard. If I'm going to stick by the truth, people were not going to like me. But I said, I don't care. I'd rather live a life with Jesus and get beat up by the world than live with the world and be departed from Jesus ultimately in the end. And that was such a turning point for me. My eyes are open. I don't look at the world the same way I used to. I hate sin. And it's all a process. Our walk with Jesus, sanctification, you know. Once we are born again, we are being sanctified until this earthly body dies. But when I surrendered myself to God, it just set in place, and I was given this peace that I was given this passion. I said to God that night, I said, God, please use me. Please use me to further your kingdom. May when people hear me, they don't hear me. They hear you, God. Please use me. Please use me. And here I am. I'm still growing. I'm still young. I'm 15. I'm about to turn 16. But just hearing that I have to completely surrender to God, I have to repent, just give my life to him and not hold on to these certain sins as a safe place to go back to. God didn't work out for me, because that was a lie. That was another lie from the enemy. When that happened, just God changed me. It was such a turning point when I understood God's not just this like warm, fuzzy feeling. He's the creator of the universe that loves us and wants us. And that's my testimony.
Hi, I'm Mackenzie. Can y'all hear me? Yes, I can't see. Okay, so I'm Mackenzie, I'm 17. I also live in Texas, and I don't know if you've seen the movie American Gospel, but American Gospel describes Texas as the buckle on the belt loop of the Bible Belt, and that is very much the case. I definitely grew up in the like middle of the Bible Belt, so everyone around me was Christian. Everyone around me goes to church, and my parents were Christian as well. But similar to Elijah, I don't know that I would say that I grew up in a Christian home. I would say I grew up in a secular home, and I grew up in church. Because I never really heard the gospel as a kid. I never really understood God as a kid. I knew stories, like I knew the story of like Noah and the ark, and I knew Moses, and I knew Jesus's birth. But I didn't know the character of God. I don't know if that was ever really explained to me. So growing up, I just viewed God as this creator who, when you're obedient to him, he will bless you. And if you're not, then he will be angry with you, and you will just not be in his blessing or his favor. So yeah, I just had I just never really understood God, and my parents had me very young. So I think they were figuring a lot of things out as they were parenting me. And they left religion very open for us to kind of decide on our own. So I grew up in and out of church. But anyways, I got into middle school, and like I said, everyone around me says they're Christian. That's like the commonplace thing. So I had a Bible verse in my bio, but outside of that, that was the extent of my Christianity. I had Song of Solomon 4:7 in my bio, which is ironic because if you've read the Song of Solomon, you know why. And, so in middle school, I had really horrible, horrible friends, and not horrible people, but just horrible friendships. We were very like, we were like the popular crowd. I've always been like a cheerleader and very outgoing. So I was in the popular crowd, and we were so mean to people. Like, we just belittled people. And I just remember, I've always been kind of an analytical thinker. So I would always see like my Christian friends, and we would be so mean to people, and we would be so judgmental towards people. But we would also like cuss and do horrible things and vape and like all that, but we would also like hold only a certain morality. So like we would judge people who didn't go to youth group. And that left me very unsettled. So by my freshman year, I stopped going to church pretty much. And I was still kind of in a horrible friend group. I ended up moving schools because the friend group kind of just disowned me. And my freshman year, when I moved schools, I got super into boys and like hookup culture. I was like 14 or 15 years old and having super inappropriate relationships with guys and super sexual and sexting and pornography, all that kind of stuff. I got into that when I was like 15 years old, 14 or 15. And that became like my reputation. Like that was what I was known for. And I got into vaping and partying. And at this time, since I had like no self-respect, I also developed an eating disorder. And because like Georgia said, that was something I could control. And, that took a huge toll on me, obviously my mental and physical health. I just got to this point where I was so wrapped up in myself. I was truly so narcissistic, but at the same time, I hated myself, which is really hard to explain, but it's just the reality. And honestly, I was so wrapped up in myself that I rarely thought of God. And it was like, I never had this relationship with God to begin with. But still, I grew up hearing about it, but I just never thought of God really. I think if you would have asked me, I would have said I was a Christian my freshman year, but I just never thought about God. And then going into my sophomore year, I got into a serious relationship with a boy who was an atheist. And I think one of our first conversation that we had, he actually was like, you know, God isn't real. And, I started thinking about God for the first time. And I was like, you know what? Like, he probably isn't. Like, that was just something I grew up hearing. And the reality is like, there's tons of world religions. How do I know this one's right? And so I just kind of gave up on God. I would say I was very agnostic because I was still like, there could be a God. I was like, that makes sense that there would be like a divine being, but I don't think that Christians have him right. I think that he doesn't care what I do, that he doesn't care about me, that he just, you know, chills in existence and anything goes kind of God, which, you know, doesn't really make sense, but it helped me. It made me feel okay with who I was. It made me comfortable in my sin. And so I was in that relationship with that guy for a really long time. And, it was a really damaging relationship. When a relationship is not built upon the foundation of Christ, it is destined to cause you some hurt. And it was a sexual relationship. I had lost my virginity to him. And, it was so painful because the way we talked to each other was so degrading. The way he talked to me was so degrading. We both watched porn, so it was just a horrible mess. He treated me like an object. I treated him like an object. So it was really hard. And then he ended up, after about 8 months or so of being together, and keep in mind, we're like 15 and 16, in the midst of this very inappropriate and just damaging relationship, we ended up breaking up. He broke up with me after eight months, and I was just, because like he had become my God, like he had become the center of my life. So I was just broken, like I was absolutely broken, and I already was before we broke up, but it was just so depressing for me, and I didn't see a purpose in living anymore because he really had become my purpose. I had centered my whole life around him. I had no friends at that point. I was like alienated with my family because I was always with him. So I had like no relationship with my mom and dad. I was just gone for like a year, just wrapped up in this guy and in myself. And so I was just so alone. And I started, of course, I didn't know what else to turn to. So I started talking to another guy and I liked him. I thought he was dope. He was like a skater, kind of like very fashionable guy, and being an image obsessed person, I was like, that's dope. That's like what I want. I started talking to this dude, had no idea he was a Christian. And looking back, I see that he was not walking with Christ, but he invited me to go to church. And I was like, sure. Like, I haven't gone in years. I don't even really believe in God. Everyone there is going to be like, what is she doing here? Like, she's crazy. She's wild. She's a mean girl, whatever. But I was like, I was so lonely and so depressed that I was like, why not? And I went to church and nothing remarkable happened. I went to youth group. Nothing remarkable happened. I don't think I heard the gospel there. It was probably just kind of a moralistic message. And so I couldn't care less. But the people were nice to me. And it was exciting to be around people who were nice to me because I was so low. And they had this camp that they were promoting. And for some reason, I still looking back, I'm not really sure why I did. I signed up for it. And I told all the friends I did have at that time, I told them, like, the friends I was partying with and vaping with and smoking with or whatever, I told them, like, my mom forced me to go to Christian camp. And so I went to camp and I was like, I'm just going to get through all, like, the Jesus stuff and it'll be fine. And because at this point, I believed that, like, a force brought us to Earth and that, anyways, I was very into New Age kind of stuff. And so I went to camp, I was like, I'll get through all the Jesus stuff, it'll be fine. And I think I heard the gospel one night. They were doing kind of an invitational kind of thing. And I heard what Jesus had done for us. I heard like that we're like lost in sin and that that we're empty without Jesus. And like something just kind of hit me. And it was like, I just knew that it was true. I knew what they said was true. I knew that I was in desperate need of a savior. And so I just broke down and started sobbing and like heaving because I realized, you know, I had this sense of remorse, but at the same time, I had an intense sense of peace because I knew that my life was going to change. I knew that Jesus was the savior that I needed. I knew that they told me that I was forgiven, and I just felt peace and love. In that moment, and just hearing the gospel and hearing who Jesus actually is, hearing who God actually is, hearing that God came down and sacrificed himself for us, I heard people say Jesus died for you growing up, but I never knew why. I never understood why. Like, why did he have to die for me? And it's because we were dead in sin without him. And so that was just, I like Georgia said, the veil was torn. Like, my eyes were opened to my own brokenness. And I went home, and it wasn't easy because all my friends were not Christians, and I used to make fun of Christians. And so I was not very public about my faith. They knew I was going to church, and they kind of were like, what's that all about? But I wasn't very public until my church offered to send me on a mission trip, and I didn't think it was possible for me to go because it was going to be really expensive, but miraculously someone paid for my trip. So I decided to go. And when I was there, I really, really, God taught me how important it is to not hide your light, to not hide what you've learned, to not hide your transformation. And it's like that day when I came back from camp, my heart was new. Like, I was totally transformed. My attitude about life was different. But like Georgia said, sanctification is such a process. And looking back, though, every struggle and every hard time has led me to sit at Jesus's feet and has led me to talk to God and led me to rely on him and not my own deeds, not my own works, but to rely on him and rely on his word for guidance. So yeah, I came home, I started being more public about my faith, and it was weird at first because everyone's like, what the heck? Like, you were just partying, like, and being super gross with dudes like 2 months ago. What is this? But yeah, so, and it's honestly just a testament to God's glory, because I'm telling you that I was the last person that anyone would have suspected. And people have told me that. They're like, I would never have thought that, like, you would be who you are now. And it's not because of anything that I've done. Everything that has honestly been a miracle. Me going to that camp was a miracle. Me, you know, hearing the gospel and it actually changing my heart, that was a miracle. So I'm just very grateful to God that throughout this whole year, the Holy Spirit has sustained me, like, through all these hard times I've dealt with this year. Not going to go into detail, but personal, like, experiences that I've gone through this year, God has really sustained me and just taught me so much. And he's provided me incredible Christian friends. So, yeah, that's my testimony.
Well, I guess that means I'm next. I love Mac's testimony. Honestly, I've heard that thing like 3 times, and it's like, it's awesome. Well, hi, I'm Colin. Guess we'll just like start from the beginning. I didn't have a dad. I've never had a dad growing up. He left before I was born. My mom was in and out of my life until last year when I asked her to just kind of stay out because it was unhealthy emotionally for me. And there were some things she said to me last year that I'd prayed about and just knew it was good for us to not be in each other's lives for at least some temporary time. It doesn't have to be forever. So I mean, to start off, really didn't have much of parent figures in my life other than my grandparents who I lived with. My grandma was the sweetest woman ever. But growing up, my grandpa was physically abusive, much more emotionally abusive. And this led to me being like a really weird kid. I didn't really know how to deal with anything. And leading up to like 5th grade and 6th grade, I was also violent. I became violent from my grandpa. I became violent from the household which I lived in, and began taking out my anger on other people, and other people would bully me. And so I would take my anger out, and I became a bully. And did what Garrett said he did, which is pick on the kids who others didn't like to become liked. But in the process of that, people still didn't like me. And I still, so I always wondered why, because I was always searching for other people to like me, because I'd never known what it was like to be loved. I never knew what it was like to have friendships or family that was true. And then going into middle school, I became friends with these two guys and this group of friends who always focused on one thing, which was, where was the party? Where were the girls? And where were the quote unquote cool kids? And I mean, you would think like in 7th grade, what kind of parties are there? We looked older, so we got into high school parties and we started drinking in 8th grade. And then we started smoking weed. And then 8th grade year into 9th grade year, the summer, we started going to even harder parties and doing harder drugs, and they weren't really doing them, but me, I just went so deep. I started drinking every single day. I would party every day. I was doing drugs every day, and as hard of drugs as I could get. Going into 9th grade year, it continued. I always fought with my parents. I hated my life. I was depressed. I had no real friends, no true friends, nothing like that. And then freshman year, I got in a super bad argument with my grandparents, and they wouldn't drive me to, it was so stupid. They wouldn't drive me to a football game. And so I got into a screaming argument with them. So I walked to the game. It was 12 miles away. And there I met my friend who would give me, his number later that night. I didn't know he would become my friend or one of my best friends ever. And, he, I guess I gave me his number. He texted me later that night and he was like, "Hey man, how are you?" And I was like, "I'm good." You know, he's talking to me about baseball because that's what I played at the time. And he just asked me after like we got done talking about baseball, he's like, "Hey, have you ever been to church?" I was like, "Nah, I've never been in my life," which I left out. My family is not Christian. Like, I live in a completely non-religious family. And I was like, "No, I've never been to church." So he's like, "You should come to Tribes," which was the youth group at the time. And so I was like, "I mean, I guess I should go." And that weekend that I'd been invited, I'd actually planned on going to a party and hopefully overdosing. I'd planned on taking my life and ending it there. But then I went to church and God just moved. I mean, it was just as soon as I walked in the building, there were people there who were loving me. And there was feelings going through my body that, and I'm not saying God's a feeling, but like I felt loved. Like I'd never felt loved before. And it really showed me like, whoa, these Christian people are kind of, they're not lame. And so I kept going every single week, every single Wednesday, and every single Wednesday I got farther and farther from committing suicide, and I stopped partying. I stopped doing sexual things with girls. I stopped being an alcoholic. It was so, like, I was so deep into those things. And then December 9th, 2017, I accepted Christ. I got baptized. But like a lot of us have been saying, I think the hardest battle came after this, when I accepted Christ. For the next 2 years, I would be a lukewarm Christian and wouldn't even know it. Everyone would tell me I'm on fire for God, but I wasn't on fire for God. I was lukewarm the entire time. I still lived in this broken home. We always fought. We always screamed, cussed at each other. There were times where I'd still drink and get drunk. There were times where I'd still mess around with girls, and I was addicted to porn. I would be sending nudes. I'd do things with girls I shouldn't be doing. And then 2018 of August, I went to church one day and I'd broken my phone. And there was this family who had said, like, hey, you can use our extra phone. And I always like to make the joke that, I mean, I guess every family has an extra phone now, but it was nice of them to do that. So I got to church. They gave me the phone. I set it up and we're sitting in service, and it's some like special worship night. I'm trying to listen to the pastor talk, but I can't hear a single thing he's saying. And then I just start praying out of nowhere to start praying for them. And I couldn't do anything but think and pray for that family. And then afterwards I go out into the lobby and I'm talking to them, and they say, like, they asked me how the message was. And I was like, I'm gonna be honest, I don't know. I didn't listen to it. I was praying for you guys. And they looked at each other and looked at me and they said, we were praying for you too. Like, we weren't listening to the message. And, I guess we just started talking more and more. And then like 10 minutes later, I was like, I don't know why I need to tell you this, but I'm trying to get fostered because I live in a really broken home. And they look at each other again, look back and say, we're one class away from having our foster license. And I was like, in that moment, I was so mind blown. I was like, God, you're real. Like that hit me right there. I was like, okay, there's no question about it. And then a month later I moved in. But then, and I had a family for 2 months. I had a sister, I had a brother. I felt loved. It was Christian. I mean, I'd never been so close to God in my life before that. And then I was told I had to move out 2 months later because my biological mom wouldn't sign the custody papers. So I go back home to my grandparents. I'm depressed. I was so sad. I couldn't get over anything. I had just gone through a breakup with someone, which like a lot of other people explained, I was seeking bad relationships. She was controlling and manipulative and did so many things to me because I thought that she loved me and I let her do it. And I was just so depressed going into January 2019. I woke up one day and no one was home, and I thought, you know what? I'm just going to take my life now. And it wasn't through drugs. It was, you know, when I was a Christian, it was when I had faith in God. It's when I knew God, I wanted to take my life. So I decided to do it. And it's right before I got ready to take my life, everything froze. And I just felt God just basically tell me, no, it's not the plan I have for you. I have a plan set for you. I have a road I've got for you to walk down. And I have a calling on your life. And you're not taking it. You're not ending it soon. So I'm not going to let you do this. And I'm going to give you that opportunity to turn away from this and turn to me. And I was like, I was fighting back. I was like, God, but you haven't been here. So why show up now? Why do you need to show up right before I'm about to end it all when everything's just for you. And he was like, but everything is for me. Life is for me. I gave you this life, so why can't you honor me with it? Why can't you just follow the plan I have for you? And I broke into tears whenever, like, when I snapped back into, like, what I like to say, like, time or reality. I just broke into tears, and I walked away from how I was going to do it. And I said to myself, I've got to change. So throughout 2019, I continued to pursue God, and I went to this church camp. And at this church camp, there was, I always tell this story, not for the relationship aspect, but because God taught me that I'm going to be used as a vessel, and I need to learn how to be used as a vessel. And I had seen this girl, and I didn't want to be there for girls, and I thought she was pretty, and I ignored her like the whole time. She comes up behind me one day and sits down behind me, and I'm like upset because I'm like, why, God? Like, why is this girl so like magnetic to me through this camp? And in the middle of the message, the pastor, or I hear God like whisper to me, I want you to pray for that girl behind you. And I was like, no, absolutely not. No. And then I didn't hear anything else for 5 minutes. I'm like, see, cool. It was just my conscience. And then the pastor says, I want everyone to stand up. So we all stand up. He's like, I want you to pray for the person next to you. And I'm like, cool. That's not the girl. That's my friend next to me. And then the guy looks in my direction and says, and someone over here needs to pray for the person behind them. And I was like, no, I can't do that. And I just did. And I just got this will, and I did it. And I prayed for her, and I knew her name somehow. I knew everything about her life, and God spoke through me. And there was nothing coming out of my mouth that was my words. It was all the Holy Spirit speaking. And I'd never met her, and it was just life-changing for me to see how God could work through me. And then the next day, the message is about dads. And like I said earlier, I don't have a dad. I've never had one. And they mentioned about kids who don't have a dad. And then after the message, my foster family came over to me, and they hugged me and said I was a part of the family. But Dave, my foster dad, didn't yet. And then he comes over, looks at me, and I ran into his arms, and it was the most, I don't talk about it a lot because it's the most emotional time of my life, because for the first time, like, I hugged my dad, and I had a dad, and it felt like I had a dad, and he looked at me and called me son and said that nothing in my life was my fault, and that he was always going to be that dad for me. And man, God showed that he could provide, like, he's the greatest father in heaven, but he provides anything that and exceeds our expectations. And I went on and grew so much, like so much, from all this. And then, yeah, I'm who I am now. So that's my testimony.
Hey, everybody. Hi, I'm Brooks. I'm going to share my testimony like everybody else. So I grew up in a Christian household. And so I've just always known, like, of Jesus, but I didn't know Jesus for myself. And let me read my notes, because I literally am so nervous for no reason. But yeah, I've always been in church, and I knew the power of, like, image and reputation because my parents were always so high up in church, but even just in my own community. And so I was raised to understand that I represent my family, that I represent God, that I represent myself. And by going to school in the suburbs, I know that I represent the whole Black community too, no matter how unfair that is. And so the pressure caused me to morph into this shapeshifter, and I was very angry, and I felt very rejected by my classmates, and just, you know, you want to be desirable, and everything is about sex appeal, especially when you're a young girl. And I just never felt like I had that. I felt like I was very, like, just corny and just very, like, geeky. And my brother, he was always so cool, but we didn't have a relationship. He pretty much, like, ignored me and, like, hated when I was around him. So we don't have really, like, a close relationship, and it still hurts to this day. But yeah, I was really resentful as a child, and that dealt with, and I dealt with a lot of, like, micromanaging, and my parents wanted me to be great and just, you know, wanting me to be excellent. And so they have good intentions, but it still felt very like hard to live up to. And so I felt like I also could not complain about anything because I have like a beautiful home and I have a lot going for me. And my parents were like, oh, you're so smart, or you're doing all these incredible things. But I still felt like just because I had my physical needs met doesn't mean that I had like my emotional needs met. And it made me feel like I had to look after validation and acceptance and approval from other people now, from friends at school, chasing after boys, and just becoming somebody that I'm not, like point blank period. In the way that you have to be cool in this world, it almost takes like just completely ignoring God and like not wanting anything to do with Christianity. And so, yeah, I'll get into that a little bit later though. But I said, as I was running for like student class president and student council, and I was in these AP classes and stuff, the relationship that I had with my dad was getting really rocky. So I had like this great external image and look like, oh wow, she has no problems. And I literally felt like a shell of a person. Like when I think back on high school, I just really feel like I was kind of like a robot. Like I just made sure that I was looking like very just good on the outside and impressive and like a blessing to my family. But I hated coming home, and I would just go straight up to my room, and I would just like after school, like, how was school? Good. All right, but I'm going to my room, shutting the door, I'm on my phone. And I especially hated church because my dad is a pastor. Both my parents are pastors, but my mom is more like passive. And so when he would be mean to me, she's like, I mean, that's your dad. Like, I gotta agree with him. And so he was so mean to me at home. And then I would see how he would treat people at church. And I would just be like, y'all are so fake. I hate this. And so I started hanging out with new friends. And I started getting into like the wrong crowd. And like Mackenzie was saying, like, they weren't bad people, but it was just a bad friendship, where it was just they're encouraging me to do things that I was curious about, but they're not gonna lead me to my good because none of us have a relationship with God. And like, now that I look back on the relationships that we had with our own families at the time, we're all broken, we're all going through something, and here we are linking up to smoke. And just every weekend we would go thrift, then we would go smoke, then we would, you know, go and paint, and then we go smoke, and we swore we were wholesome, but we weren't doing anything wholesome. And then that's when like my attachment to pornography grew. And the first time that I ever watched that was when I was 8 years old. I got exposed to that really early, and it led me to just, I guess, it skewed my perception of people too. And so I feel like, and we don't talk about it enough, but when you watch pornography a lot, it will skew the way that you see people. You will be objectifying them. You don't see them as somebody of like value. You just see them as somebody you can get some type of temporary satisfaction from. And so I didn't even realize that. Like, I'm not into psychology at 8 or 9 years old, so I didn't know. But my resentment towards my parents led me to being open-minded towards astrology and law of attraction and manifestation, because they were non-traditional and I was always super creative and that's all I cared about. But it seemed like the more aesthetic way of going towards peace, right? Like, they make it so beautiful and they make it so just shiny, but it's all deception. And my goals and my ambitions became God to me, and I started to just live for myself. So I got to church. Not yet. I got to college. And I went to Howard University with no obligation to fake enthusiasm for church at all. Like, didn't want to go to church. So I kind of turned agnostic. Like, I didn't really pray anymore. Unless I was like in a pickle. Like, it really took me going through something for me to be like, okay, in Jesus' name. Cause I always knew to like rely on Jesus, but I didn't really know him. And I remember I texted my brother about Jesus. Somehow it came up in text, and he told me, yeah, Jesus and God are the same person. I was like, what? Like, I thought it was God and then Jesus. And I got confused. And I was at this time, like 18 years old, grew up in church, didn't know like basic stuff like that. And so I got to school with no obligation of fake enthusiasm for church, had a porn addiction. I had a smoking habit still, and I had an open mind towards sexuality. And by my sophomore year, I was in an emotionally abusive relationship with another girl. And then I had a codependent friendship with another girl who I was convinced that I was actually in love with. And then at the same time that all this mess is happening, I have a podcast telling people how to optimize their spiritual and mental health. Like, go figure. And so I was deeply tied to that friendship, and it led to a lot of jealousy. Because the friend that I really was super close to, she had a new friend. And then I think she was low-key trying to, like, get away from me because, I mean, I was awful. Like, I don't blame her. But at the same time, I just was like, no, this is my friend. And, like, I was very possessive and very entitled, and everything was about me, and especially because of my spiritual practices at the time. When you care about meditation and, like, all that different, not just meditation, but, like, when everything is about the self, how you feel, what you want, then if anything comes against those things, it's going to be a problem. And so that brings you, it makes you kind of like really rageful and very entitled. And so the mistreatment of the girl that I was in a relationship with, it became too much and I cut it off. And then I was more open to the idea of living for God because law of attraction, meditation, astrology never gave me any freedom. And it just made me more self-centered with poor to absolutely no boundaries because there's no acknowledgement of sin. There's no definite right or wrong when you do these things. It's just love and light, but it's all demonic deception. It's like there's no sense of this, you don't do this. It's just like, you know, if you feel this way, if it doesn't harm anybody, but at the same time, you're harming yourself. So it's like, I'm literally doing damage to myself. How can I love anybody else if I'm not even loving myself correctly? You know, we all know this, love your neighbor as you love yourself. And I hated myself because I'm doing these things. And my sweet mate told me about a church that she loved and she got baptized out of nowhere. And I didn't think that she was going to dedicate her whole life to God anytime soon. Cause we were both like, yeah, we grew up in Christian households. Da, da, da. I'm living in sin, not really trying to get out of it. And then all of a sudden she comes back to the dorm and is like, I got baptized. And I'm like, wait, so what happened? So I ended up going to her church and I loved it. And it was surprising because I grew up so ashamed of how corny Christianity is. And I didn't want anything to do with it. I was so embarrassed of having a family who loves Jesus. I wanted to be cool so bad. And there was nothing more lame than loving Jesus, I thought. And I used to just mock even the people that I look up to now. And it's just awful. When I think about how judgmental I was, but I was really just insecure because I didn't know my identity and I would shapeshift. I have so many different phases of who I was and who I pretended to be. And I just always was trying to find my identity and maybe a new celebrity, maybe in the music that I like, maybe my abilities, maybe my talents. And I just could not find out who I was. And then I really loved going to that church, and the first sermon series that I heard from them was about godly relationships. And that just changed everything. And I went to worship nights after that. And then I got baptized, I got baptized on November 11, 2018 because it was 11-11 and I was still into angel numbers low key. And so I was like, oh my God, that's such a cute date. So I got that one. But then I felt really guilty about that because I was like, that's not a good reason to ever get baptized. But then I realized that God would, you know, set something up to draw me in to, you know, dedicate my life to him. So I'm like, God will use everything for his good. And I don't know, I couldn't find any videos on YouTube or any articles about like guilt after getting baptized because you like the date. Like I couldn't find it, but, and then I really love the fact that when I was at church, it was saying like, if you give life to God, then it won't, like you can't stop what God wants to do in your life. Like the Holy Spirit, you cannot stop it. And that really gave me comfort because I sabotaged everything and everything good that I wanted, I felt like I ruined it. And so the fact that it's like, you can't stop God from doing good in your life made me feel like that. Okay, cool. I'll try this because I can't ruin it. Like I do most things or everything. And I still didn't know if God loved me though, even after getting baptized. I worked so hard to earn his love because I never heard the gospel. Now I'm 20 years old, grew up in church, got baptized, never heard the gospel. It just shows you that it's not in churches anymore sometimes. Like for the majority of it, it's just not there. And so that summer, I had an internship at Spotify and I was living my best life. And even though he's a false teacher, I didn't know it at the time, I was popping in my Joel Osteen, headed to World Trade Center 4 and just really living, you know, what I thought was good. And I was still smoking. I was still using my body to get attention because I was feeling myself and I got confidence in things that I was doing and the accomplishments that I had. And I was like, yeah, okay, now I need to add like sex appeal to it. And it's just ridiculous. And I just started, I kept cussing at the people that I was around, my friends at the time back at college, they weren't good influences. And so we continued to, I was like this new person wanting to change and be closer to God, but it didn't work out with who I was around because they just weren't good influences. And so I'm in New York, I'm having this internship, life is going well. And then afterwards, on June 20th, 2019, just a year ago, since yesterday, my Grandma Jones passed away. And we were so close, so, so close. And she was the image of a God-fearing woman that I had. The way that I felt closest to her after she died was that, you know, she would just embody the word of God so much that when I missed her, I read my Bible because I know that that's how she became who she is or was, you know? And so after that summer, I got back to campus and I had to face the same friendships that I felt miserable in. And I only hung out with these girls with, okay, so I have to use my fingers. I'm a very visual person. So I had the friend that I was codependent with, and then she had like three other friends, right? And we were all a friend group per se, but I only liked the one that I was codependent on, so I made friendships with the rest of them. And so after I got back to hanging out on campus, and I just realized I felt miserable around them, like the constant auditioning to be included to their friend group, I was like, I can't do this anymore. Like, this is so fake, and I don't enjoy being around you guys anymore. Like, I don't feel like I have to pretend to be anyone anymore. So why am I here? And so I did the hardest thing that I've ever done in my life. I let them go. I swore that I was going to have that friend that I was codependent on in my wedding. I thought that we were going to be best friends for life. Like, I couldn't imagine it. Like, she brought me so much joy, so much peace, so much, just love. I felt so good when I was around her. And that was probably why she had to go, because I idolized her. I made her my everything. And yeah, I couldn't stay in that friendship because it was rooted in dishonesty. And I was suppressing my relationship with Jesus to be friends with them. And this brought emotions from when I hurt my cousins the year earlier, because the way that I did it, the way that I got rid of them was just through Instagram DM. Like, I was like, I can't do this anymore. Like, bye y'all. And like, individual ones, one that I was codependent with, gave her a little bit more respect. We had one last conversation. But then after that, it was like, now I have four girls at this school on the small campus that hate me. And I know it. And it's going to feel like I'm getting like chased by Pac-Man or something, like trying to avoid them on campus. And I just felt very just cornered, and I was afraid to leave my dorm. I was like so terrified of them and to see them around. And yeah, it brought back ends of when I hurt my cousins the year earlier. I just wasn't there for them. They went through a divorce. I mean, their family went through a divorce, and I just didn't know what to say. So I didn't say anything. I was just not there, and I allowed the enemy to torment me, and I hated myself. And the same way that I just dropped them, it made me feel like, oh, like you're toxic or you're cursed. Like, other people have genuine friendships and they have friends for a long time, but you don't. Like, I had a genuine loathing for who I was, and I felt incapable of being a good friend. And I felt like if anybody wanted to get close to me, like that's something that I should warn them about, and that they shouldn't do that because I don't know how to love people well. Like, I'm not a good friend. Like, that was my whole identity. I hated myself. I can't even begin to tell you. And then after I felt that way, my grandpa passed away too. So like, all these things happened after I was baptized. Like, my grandma passed away. I like went through all this different stuff. My friends, I cut them off. Then my grandpa passed away. And that's when I made impulsive plans to study abroad in Brazil because I was too scared to even leave my dorm. I didn't even want to be in the country anymore. I just wanted to run away from everybody. And I based my self-worth on if my friends liked me, and they all hated me. So I was like, bet, I need to go. Like, I'm not a, like, it was just really crazy. I thought that I was a good person if they thought that I was a good person. And when they didn't think I was a good person anymore, I would imagine scenarios of their sisters talking about me behind my back. I would imagine their mom hating me, just like looking up and making ideas of like who hates me and then trying to like, you know, meditate on that. It was just so evil to do to myself. And so I based my self-worth on my friends like me or they hated me. And I failed two classes that semester and I went home. So everything just started to collapse and I just didn't care anymore. I just lost hope in every way, I feel like. And so while I was on my way back from home, because it was now Christmas break, I stumbled upon Wretched TV videos. And if you guys don't know who that is, it's Todd Friel on YouTube. And he was having debates with college students who asked questions that I had even after being baptized. And that was my introduction to apologetics, which Georgia mentioned earlier in her testimony. And the people who did not believe in Christianity or believe in God at all, they would drag Christianity. Like I was seeing on Twitter, I would overhear it in conversations, especially going to a HBCU, I'm hearing that, you know, Christianity is a white man's religion. And that, like, why would you ever be in, you know, love God or love Jesus because, you know, he's this, whatever. They were just really dragging. I didn't have any type of opposition against it at all. And so I felt really discouraged, especially my philosophy classes. They would tear Christianity up. There's so many different gods, but they only choose Jesus. It's just really, and I would get so upset. But yeah, anyways. But I couldn't explain my relationship with God. And I was honestly, and I felt like I was just doing wishful thinking. Like I had some evidence in my life that I was unable to share, but I was unable to share my faith. And then I didn't even have answers for why Jesus died or why Jesus, why couldn't it be my next door neighbor? Like, why couldn't he die for my sins? Like, what is the difference between Jesus and anybody else? I didn't have these questions answered. And so I ate those videos up, and in 2019, I accepted Jesus for real this time, and I had a revelation of what my sin meant for me in light of eternity after watching Ray Comfort talk with college students on Living Waters Ministry videos with Georgia. Yeah, well, we used to talk about that in the comments section all the time, but yeah, like, those videos changed my life. To those days, like to this day, I always refer those people to those videos because I never understood the legal implications of my sin in front of a holy God, him being a perfect judge. And, you know, you think, oh, I'm just living this life or whatever, or the image is good. God does not care about your image. God does not care about your reputation. He sees the heart, and your heart is wicked. Who can know it? And I really needed to get a new heart completely. And so I became obsessed with thinking about how temporary everything is. And especially after my grandma passed away, like seeing her in the casket, knowing that her body was there, but she wasn't there anymore. It tripped me out because I'm like, the reason why I love her is not her body, but the part of her that I love, it's gone forever. And where did it go? And so I was just thinking about, you know, this won't last. Like, we could die tomorrow. And I just really was thinking about how meaningless my life would be if I didn't lead people to Christ, because, or if I just stored up all my treasure on earth, because how short is life in comparison to eternity, and how Jesus is the only way to the Father. And I still get upset that I didn't know the gospel before I was 20 years old. But that's why I shared on TikTok. And I had no intention on starting a TikTok or having my name associated with Jesus in any way, because like I said, my image, my reputation of being cool, being liked, having people look at me and see a certain thing was super important. Like that was priority, point blank period. But I can't do that anymore. I can't care more about that than I care about people's souls. Or know that Jesus is the only way and not share with anybody. Like that's just a low. And so I give a lot of my faith, not all my credit, of course, all my credit to God, but I do give a lot of credit to the faithfulness and the obedience and the willingness to share the gospel that the TikTok creators have. Because if it wasn't for seeing everybody who's younger than me or a little bit older than me, I would feel so weird, and I would feel like I'm the only one in the world who has this love for God at my age. And it just means a lot that you are so willing to be on, to share Christ and to be a light, because it gives me a lot of inspiration. And so since the Holy Spirit drew me in, the relationships that I have with my, the relationship that I have with my parents has really improved. I'm no longer secretive with them. Like, they know my testimony. Before I started my YouTube channel, I was like, Mom and Dad, this, everything. This is my entire testimony. Like, I want you guys to know before I go online and tell all these different people what I was doing or who I was before. And now my private life is actually matching up with what I present before, like, before I was a hypocrite. Like, I wish I could, I would be the poster child. And I actually claim Jesus now, which is a miracle in itself, because I almost thought I was going to be Buddhist or something. I didn't even look into Buddhism. That's the funny part. I just knew I didn't want anything to do with Jesus. So the fact that I claim him and the fact that I want to be in circles that love him and worship him is really crazy. And now I know who he is for myself, and I understand my worth as his daughter, and I haven't watched porn in over a year. I have no desire to, especially now that I understand more about how it feeds into sex trafficking and how it is just so evil, and it's literally poisoning the minds of young children. The fact that almost everybody up here was talking about how they had an instance with it is just shows how evil it is, and it's pervasive. But anyways, oddly passionate about that. He's given me a desire to please him and love him over any sexual temptation or friendship. I don't have a desire to be with a woman anymore. And I didn't really ever before. I think it was just by curiosity. But even just acting out of those weird things that were planted in my heart through watching dirty stuff, I think that that's what perverted my own way of looking at, you know, my sisters. So God, he's healed that, and he continues to heal it when, of course, temptation comes up. And Jesus has given me the confidence to forsake everything else. And right now he's helping me forsake laziness and desperation and putting my hope in temporary things like a career after college or having a husband. He wants me to focus on him. And he tells us to not be anxious about our lives. He tells us to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added on to you. And Jesus didn't come to call the righteous, but the sinners. And he wants you, if you feel sick, if you feel broken or toxic, insecure, or like a hypocrite, if you struggle with jealousy and anger and abandonment and rejection issues, if you're bound to the opinions of other people, Jesus isn't only able to restore you, but he's willing, like he wants to. So I really, that's my full testimony. Yeah, just really thank you so much for having me on this call, y'all. This is so cool. And I love every single one of you.
Okay, is this working? Hi, I'm Leanna. Okay, this is so weird. Okay. First off, I just want to say that if you hear anything, it's almost Canada Day. I'm Canadian, so if you're wondering, yeah. If you hear any fireworks, that's why. Also, I have a younger brother who's like 5, so if you hear any yelling, that's him. Also, it's kind of sucks that you guys made me go last, because now I have to follow up all those amazing testimonies that were really awesome, and I love all of you guys. I just want to say that, like, I think it's amazing that there are so many people on here right now, and they're just gathered to hear about the transformative power of the Holy Spirit. I'm really nervous too, so if I like stumble, I'm gonna try my best to articulate myself. So I have a quote that I wrote down by C.S. Lewis that like really sums up what I'm gonna get into, and it goes like this: I believe in Christianity as I believe the sun has risen, not only because I see it, but because by it I see everything else. So like what Garrett was talking about earlier about worldviews, this is like really what I want to get into. And there are two main worldviews in my story, in my testimony. The first one is one that sees the world as a result of a mindless, unguided process, one that faces an inevitable oblivion, that we're just completely meaningless and we're drifting in a purposeless void, just like, hi, you live and then you die, and then that's basically it.
The other worldview that I've experienced in my life is one that sees the world as a purposeful world that was designed by an all-loving God who represented his love for you on the cross when he gave his only son to die for our sins. So those are two very contrasting worldviews, but they're two worldviews that I've had in my life, and not only have I had them and I've experienced them, but I've experienced the consequences of those worldviews in my life and what that meant in my relationship and my mental health. So a lot of people in this call, they grew up in the church. I did not grow up in the church at all. I did not even start reading my Bible until a couple of months ago. I knew nothing about the Bible. So I grew up with Christian parents, but I did not grow up in the church. I thought I kind of was a Christian. I believed in God. I accepted the idea of God. But I was not really a Christian. I did not know what it meant until I got around grade 8. It seems like grade 8, like grade 7 and 8, everyone started tripping up. Like, I don't know what it is. But grade 8 was terrible. Grade 8 sucked. I hated that year. People were talking about how they started doubting God. I didn't doubt God. I fully rejected the idea of God. I hated God. I blasphemed God. I literally remember getting into so many arguments with my dad about God, and I'd be like, God sucks. Like, why would he do this? And I would literally go on my computer and I'd look up like sexist Bible verses, and I'd copy and paste them and take them completely out of context. And I'd be like, see, look at this ancient text. Like, it's literally so sexist. Like, I can't believe in your God. And I hated God, and I hated everything about God. So I was so lost. And the thing about my life at that time is that not only did I hate God, but I was extremely depressed. I was in this dark hole, okay? And I don't even know how to explain it, but I felt like I was walking through life and that's it. Like, I was just waking up and I was going through the motions, but I wasn't present. I wasn't there. And I had a huge problem in my grade 8 year. The teachers like contacted my parents. I was self-harming in school, like in school. And it was a cry for help. People were so concerned. They're like, what the heck is going on with this girl? She's so absent. I was so distant from everyone. I can't even explain to you how dead I felt. Like, I was not there. I was dead on the inside. And it was such a hard time for me. And I was really influenced by a lot of my friends. There was this one girl that I was really, really influenced by. And she just really, she really influenced me in a really bad way. And the second I cut her off from my life, I started to stop being super involved in my like devout atheism. I became more of an agnostic towards the end of my grade 8 year. Going into grade 9, I was more of an agnostic. This is like kind of weird, but okay. So in grade 9, I went through a lot of like really hard things in my life. So my mom, she got diagnosed with cancer, breast cancer. And the day she told me that, it was like terrible. Obviously, I was like so sad. Obviously, anyways. And then 2 days later, after she told me that, our house caught fire and burned down. I lost all my clothes. I lost all my possessions. Everything that we had was just burnt and gone. So my mom was basically dying, and our house was gone. And we were like, what the heck is going on? And I remember standing there. We had to rent out a hotel. I was so confused. And I was like, dude, this is proof. God's not real, right? Because he would never put me in a position like this if he loves me. And I went through such a bad depression at that point in my life. Like, I remember I would literally like stay up all night because I couldn't sleep. And the thing is, when you have a worldview like this where everything is meaningless, you try to do anything you can to distract yourself from being alone. Like, I would do anything I could to distract myself from being alone, but the second I had to get off my phone, right, to go to bed, I just sit in bed. And that was like the first time I'd be alone with my thoughts, and they would be recurring, like terrible things, like, you're gonna die, and it's not gonna matter, and everyone's gonna fade away, and this life doesn't matter because everything is just so meaningless, and you don't matter, you're just a speck of dust in this grand scheme, and you don't matter. And I would constantly think those things, and if I constantly thought those things, I would go through life looking at life in that way. I didn't look at people as image bearers of God. I looked at them as just like a result of random evolutionary processes and nothing more than that. Everything was stripped and devoid of meaning, and it made no sense to me. And that started showing in my schoolwork. Like, my teachers are suckers, okay, because they're Canadian. So if the second you mention mental health, they're like going to give you good grades. And they knew that I was going through stuff. So like, they give me good grades anyways. And I remember I'd go to my like first period class, and I'd sleep in class, and I'd literally be sleeping, and it was, like, robotic, so, like, who cares, it was gross. And the teacher comes up to me and he's like, what's wrong with you? And I was like, I don't know. And everyone saw that there was something so, so wrong with me. And so I started going through life like that until one day I was like, I've had enough of this. And I know that people are going to think this is weird, but my political views had like such a big influence on like the way that I viewed God. And I was a hardcore leftist when I was an atheist, like hardcore. But the second I became a conservative, I had to appeal to a higher moral standard. So it made no sense for me to be a conservative without appealing to a higher moral standard. For example, I became pro-life. Then I was like, why does it matter if nothing matters, right? There's no absolute moral code that I have to appeal to in order to have these views. And I saw that everybody around me had these views too. Like all these conservatives were Christians. So as I started ideologically moving to the right, I was like, dang, what's going on? So I put on this Christian front as sort of an embellishment for my political view or my ideology. I was not a Christian though. I said I was a Christian. I did kind of accept the idea of God, not really, but it was whatever. And so, fast forward to like last summer, this is going to be a pretty short testimony, okay? Because like I'm really hungry and I need to get some food in me, okay? So fast forward to last summer, I was in Romania, just chilling in the Tsara, okay? And my dad introduced me to this author called Fyodor Dostoevsky. And if you're not a book nerd, you won't know who that is. That's some random Russian guy, right? But he was a philosopher who basically, he presented the idea of God in such a beautiful way in his books. So I started reading some of his books, and there's this one book. It's called The Idiot. And I was like, this is a book about me? Like, how did Fyodor Dostoevsky know? But I started reading the book. It's a book that is inspired by Fyodor Dostoevsky's life. And Fyodor Dostoevsky, he was a devout Christian. But before he was, right, he basically was sentenced to a Siberian internment camp, and he was on death row, and he was about to die. And the second he was about to die, he saw life, like this veil was lifted from above his eyes, and he saw life in a totally different light. He saw the snow glistening in the sun, he saw all these beautiful things, these intricate, beautiful things, and he said, wow, this is a beautifully designed world. And he said in the book, like, if I had an opportunity to switch my body with a homeless person on the street just to continue living in this beautiful world, I would. And I was like, dang. I've never heard somebody talk about the world in such a beautiful way. I always thought it was just some random place that we were just put into. We have no choice but to live in this life. And so I started being introduced to apologetics, to the idea, the defense of the Christian faith, and it played a huge part. I'm a very analytical person, as Mackenzie said, I am too. I love to read. I love to be able to defend my faith. I love to argue. That's something about me. Dude, I argue so much. It's kind of bad. But it really changed my perspective on things. And a lot of people were saying on this live how, like, doesn't, like, if you're a Christian, live a Zoom call, that even after you accept Christ, you're going to struggle. And I wrote something down here that really, like, just stuck with me. You know, the struggles don't change. You're still going to struggle, but your outlook on them changes. The outlook on that struggle that you have changes completely. Like, I remember seeing my mom on the verge of death, but if I had the viewpoint that I have now with this peace, this in my soul, I would have said, you know, it's God's will. And there's such a difference in the way that you see the world. Christianity, it permeates through every aspect of your existence. So I accepted the idea of God at that point, but I wasn't truly saved. Hold up, I wasn't saved yet. I accepted God. I was like, you know, God, you're real. Sure, fine. And I remember I was in my bed. Okay, it's not that crazy, but it's kind of crazy to me. So I'm gonna say it. I was in bed one night and I was praying. I know I'm literally all over the place. Okay, my mind is like really like all over the place and I'm really all over the place. So I'm so sorry for everyone watching who's like weirded out by me. I was in my bed and I was praying to God. I didn't even really know God at that point, but I was like, you know what, I'm gonna try. And I was like, God, if you're there, please just show yourself. You know, like I'm waiting. Like, where are you? Please, I just want you. Because I need you. Because without you, my life has no meaning. I know this. So where are you? I want meaning. And I specifically said these words. I was like, God, show me the light, please. Not even kidding. I put my head down on my pillow. my lights turned on. Not even kidding. Not even kidding. And I was like, oh, what? And I literally knew in that moment. I was like, that's God. I wasn't even, because like there was a part in my head that was like, nah, I was like, shut up. Shut up. Literally, I asked him to show me the light. Shut up. That was him. That was literally him. I was like, shut up. So annoying. That enemy in the back of my head. I was like, no. He literally delivered exactly what I asked for. And not only did the lights turn on, but I had this extreme feeling of peace, like, just bestowed upon me. I was like, because I'm such a scared person. If my lights just turned on in the middle of the night, I would literally run to my parents' room and be like, help me. There are demons in my room. But the lights turned on, and I was like, dang, that's God. I wasn't scared at all. I was so at peace. And I called my friend, and I was like, you won't believe what just happened to me. And they're like, calm down. It could have been, like, an electrical, like, glitch. And I was like, no, it was God. So I accepted the idea of God, but it hadn't fully permeated through my life because I had no idea what repentance was. I had no idea what it meant to truly give your life to Christ, to live as a servant to Christ. So one day I downloaded TikTok and I remember seeing Georgia's videos all over my For You page. Yeah, I see you, Georgia. And I was like, and I remember I thought Georgia was really old too. I was like, why is this 20-year-old woman telling me to do all these things? I was like, no, I don't want to repent. And I was like, I remember seeing Georgia and I was like, dang, like, get off my back. Like, I don't need to do all this stuff, you know? And I saw all these other Christians. I was like, get off my back. I don't need to do all this stuff. And keep in mind that I believed in God, but I had not read my Bible at all. Like, at all. I didn't even want to read my Bible. I was like, this is boring. This is written in some ancient language I can't even understand. It was so weird. But it came to a point where I can't even exactly, everyone can, like, pinpoint exactly where they were saved. It's, like, really hard for me to do that. But it came to a point where a couple months ago, I was like, I need to have a change in my life because I said that I accepted God, but I didn't. I did not accept God. So, oh my gosh, what was that? So, basically... So I'm really dehydrated and hungry. So basically, I decided to start reading my Bible. I was like, you know what, I'm going to read my Bible. I started watching this show called The Chosen. It's like really good. You should watch it. It's like free. I was like, dang, Jesus is so adorable. Like, he's so loving. I never got this full picture of Jesus before, but I did. And I was like, wow. Started reading my Bible, and I remember just fully coming to this conclusion in my bed. Everyone's in their rooms, in their beds, praying to God, but like, I was like, God, I'm a sinner. I'm dead in my sin. I need you to give me a new heart. I need you to help me, to restore me. And I was literally like, God, I'm yours. I'm yours now. And I ain't ever going back. Hey, I ain't ever going back to the world that mistreated me so much. I was like, God, I'm yours. I'm like paraphrasing, okay? It was a pretty long conversation. I started crying. I was bawling. I was bawling in my bed. I was like, God, I don't deserve your grace, but you're so good. It was awesome. And I remember in that moment, like Garrett said, I have never in my life ever experienced something like this. And it was like extreme peace just like fell over me. Like, have you ever been in the pool? You jump in the pool and you're like under the water and you're like, wow. It was like that. Like, everything slowed down. I felt like I was completely at peace. And I just remember feeling these words, and I was like, everything is going to be okay. And I just knew in that moment, I felt like a hug. It's so weird. I knew in that moment, God just picked me up. He grabbed me. He was like, you're mine now. You're mine. And I was like, yes, I am. So yeah. And then I was like, you know, I should probably start, you know, sharing the gospel with people. So that's what I did. If any of you are scared to share your faith, you know what? An awkward moment is worth it. Literally everyone I meet now, I'm like, girl, let me tell you about Jesus. And they're like, who's this Jesus freak talking to me? I'm like, you don't know what's about to hit you, girl. And we get into so many conversations. I ordered like 600 gospel tracks. I'm on a roll. Anyways, I hate ending things, so I don't know what to say. Can someone take over? This was a good testimony, but I don't know what to say now. Elijah, where are you? You're good at talking.
Right here. Liana, you killed it. Guys, I just want to hype Liana up real quick. What y'all don't know is before the live, she was like panicked about having to share. And she popped off. So I need all y'all to...
No.
Thanks. I did a great job. Cool beans. So Tonight we talked a lot about, I mean, testimonies, you know, it's about the story of your salvation and, you know, what Jesus has done in your life. And a lot of us talked about, you know, times in our life of being lukewarm or times where, you know, we thought we were a Christian, but we really weren't. And we had that moment where we realized that we needed repentance and that we needed Christ. And so I would be doing everyone here a disservice if I didn't offer that same thing to you. Like, I just would. All of us talking about, you know, salvation, the joy and the peace and just everything that we have in having Christ. I would be doing you all a disservice if I didn't offer that same salvation up to you. And the reality is that Jesus has offered it for you, that he went to the cross so that your sins could be paid for. And so, I mean, I'm at a point where, like, being here with you, where there's no way that there isn't someone here who wants Jesus for the first time. And I'm going to trust and believe that. So I'm going to go through the process and tell y'all what it means to be saved real quick. I'm going to wrap it up. I know we've been sitting here for literally 3 hours almost. And that was not anticipated, but Holy Spirit did what the Holy Spirit wanted to do. And so I'm going to explain this to y'all, and then I'm going to send you on your merry little way. So let's talk real quick. We talk about being saved. Well, what are we being saved from? Romans 5:9 tells us that we are saved from the wrath of God. We're saved from the consequences of our sin. What we understand is what some people talked about tonight is that we have a holy, perfect, beautiful, amazing, almighty, eternal God. And when we defy him as creation, when we rebel and we sin against him, like, we deserve punishment for that. See, but our God is merciful and he is full of love and scandalous mercy. And so he says, you know what, I'm going to do something. And so despite his holiness and despite our sinfulness, he says, let me send my son. And he comes down to earth. Jesus comes down being fully man and fully God, suffers on the cross, dies, and rises again in 3 days and ascends to heaven, conquering sin and death forever, right? And so he says, you know what, my children, my creation, I'm going to save you from the consequences of your sin so I can adopt you into my family so you can become my child. And I'm going to bear your pain, and I'm going to bear your guilt, and I'm going to bear your sin, and I'm going to take all that for you. And so we talked about tonight, all of us, just about how, like, how much the Lord has changed our lives. And I can say this on everyone's behalf. None of us here talking about Christ would ever, in a million years, change anything about our story. Never. Because Christ has led us to this point. Every event was significant. And none of us would ever, ever desire any, none of us would ever wish that we were not saved by Christ. That's what I'm trying to get across here. Ever. Because Jesus is our everything. And so I am confidently assured that there are people here who maybe grew up in the church, but they don't really know Jesus. Or maybe you've been an atheist all your life, that you've never even been to church. Whichever extreme you're on, I am confidently assured that the Holy Spirit has softened your heart. We were praying for you before this call, waiting for this moment. And so I am assured that people in here are ready and crying out for Christ, that your heart longs for something greater, that you're thinking, you know what, I've tried everything in this life. I've tried it all. I've tried drugs. I've tried sex, whatever it is to try and fulfill yourself, and it's not worked. It's because you were made for God, that you have a vacuum in your soul made to be filled by the eternal, infinite God. And when you try and fill it with other things, you leave yourself more broken and full of more pain. Jesus is the one you need, and he is calling out to you and crying out to you. So the Bible talks about salvation. What we see in the early parts of the gospel is Jesus says, repent and believe. So what does that mean? He says, repent. To repent means to, in Hebrew, means to change your mind, and in the Greek, it means to turn away. And so what that means basically is that you look at your sin and you turn from your sin and to Christ. You don't simply turn from sinfulness to righteousness. No, you turn from dead in sin to alive in Christ. You turn your face from sin to Jesus, right? Repenting is understanding why sin is so evil. We repent when we understand that Jesus is beautiful and amazing and holy. He loves us unlike any other love we've experienced, and he died because of our sin, right? He didn't just die for our sin, but because of our sin. Right? And our sin is inherently evil and wrong. And so we have to look and say, God, my sin is so evil. I don't want it anymore. Like, you died for this. So I'm done with it. Not to say that you'll never sin again, but it is the initial turning away and understanding that Jesus came to save you from those very things. So then it says, So we repent, right? We recognize the evil of our sin. We confess and we turn away from it. And then it is to believe in Christ, to believe upon Christ as your Savior, Savior from that sin. It is to say, sin is evil and I am damned because of it, but Jesus, you are greater and you came to save me from it. And so I believe that you and you alone can do that. So believing in Jesus is not simply believing that Jesus exists, but believing that the words of the word of God is true and that Jesus will fulfill every promise he made. And one of those promises is that he can save. And so it is trusting in Christ that he will rescue you from your sin, right? Rescue you from it and save you from it. And we believe every promise in the Bible. We believe that our God is eternal. We believe that Jesus died and rose again. We believe all of it and we trust in it. We know the power in it. And finally, Romans 10 talks about confessing with your mouth that Christ is Lord. What does that mean, Elijah? Well, let me tell you. My favorite way to explain this is talking about what Lord is. In the Hebrew, the word for Lord, it's obviously written in Greek, but I like to use the Hebrew word, is Elohim, right? The Bible talks about God being our Elohim, which is Lord, right? But Elohim more directly translates to a sovereign one, right? But we call him my Lord, right? So he's not just, right? Obviously, we believe our God is sovereign over everything, but it means you are personally saying, God, be sovereign over me, that he sits upon the throne of your life. And so it is to say that Jesus, I belong to you. Everything in me belongs to you. It is humbling yourself and putting yourself in the hands of God, confessing that he is Lord of all and Lord over you specifically, that you belong to him, that you give him your sin and your pain and everything that you are so you can live for him forever. So those are the three things, right? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray. And if you are stuck in lukewarmness, if you are stuck in your sin and you want Jesus for the first time right now for real, and you're done trying to recommit and be good enough, you're done trying to chase, you're done chasing after everything, you're done putting on a fake face of Christianity, and you want Jesus for real and genuinely in a relationship with him that satisfies, I want you to follow through with me. But understand, there is no prayer that can save you. I said a billion prayers before I got saved because my heart wasn't repenting, my heart wasn't believing, and my mouth wasn't confessing of his lordship. So let me tell you something. When I lead you through this and when we pray, it is not simply the words. It is not simply uttering a spiritual statement that makes you saved. It is genuinely hating your sin and genuinely believing upon Christ to save you. So uttering these words after me does not save you. Don't believe in a prayer. Believe that Jesus will save you and rescue you. I don't follow in the whole notion of the sinner's prayer that you can say, Jesus, I accept you and it's done and it's over. But no, you are turning to Christ once and for all and following him forever. So I'm going to pray, and I would encourage you that if you want Jesus Christ right now, follow with me. You can say it out loud in your head. And if you are saved, if you are secure in your salvation, you better be praying for these souls right now, okay? And so if you want Jesus right now, I'd encourage you to pray along with me, okay? Heavenly Father, God, I repent of my sin. I recognize that it is evil. I know that it is the reason you had to die. I know that it's why I'm separated from you. And so, God, I turn from my sin. I hate it. It cannot satisfy me. And it has brought damnation upon me. But Jesus, I believe on you. That you came to die for me, and that you rose again. So Jesus, save me from my sin. Forgive me of my evil. Pull me out of my mess, and rescue me from the consequence of my sin. Jesus, I confess that you are Lord. Once and for all, I put my life in your hands. I belong to you. I give you everything, God. Father, forgive me. Holy Spirit, fill me. And Lord, may I follow you for all my days. I thank you for everything. And in Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. Homies, listen. Look, I believe with everything in me that if in this moment you have cried out to Jesus for the first time with the genuineness of genuine genuineness of your heart, seeking him as savior, knowing that he is what you need, that right now that your soul is saved forever. You have been given a new heart, and the angels are celebrating in heaven, partying for your sake. Praise God.